Preface of The Origins of Christianity by Thomas Whittaker. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. The Origins of Christianity, with an outline of von Manen's analysis of the Pauline literature, by Thomas Whittaker. Preface. After reading the celebrated article on Paul in the third volume of the Encyclopedia Biblica, my thought was that, if the conclusions stated could be established by analysis, then Professor von Manen must be regarded as the Copernicus of New Testament criticism. To place the Pauline writings, along with the rest of the New Testament, in the second century, would both remove an anomaly and make possible a consistent deduction of the process by which Christianity came into being. Study of his original work has, so far, confirmed my view. At the same time, I was under the impression that the result might be also to disclose a stratum of genuine historical tradition in the gospel narrative. I did not, indeed, think that, for example, a single indubitable saying of Jesus could be determined. What I imagined might become a practicable problem was to trace the original Judeo-Christian movement, as distinguished from Pauline or Gentile Christianity, to an impulse from a personal teacher who had made a profound impression by his continuance of the effort of Hebrew prophecy towards universalizing the mainly national ethics of older Hebraism. The actual Jesus would thus have been a teacher who did from a religious base what had already been done philosophically by the successors of Plato and Aristotle, and especially by the Stoics, who before the Christian era had quite definitely universalized the civic morality of an earlier phase of social life. According to this view, the conception of Jesus as the Jewish Messiah, and afterwards as the Son of God in a special sense, did not proceed from himself, but from his followers and the succeeding generations. Paulinism was a form taken by an advancing movement of speculative theology among the Greek-speaking Christian converts in Syria and Asia Minor. This is something like the view suggested by Professor von Manen himself, though I am not aware that he has stated precisely what kind of teacher he conceives Jesus to have been. In one place, he ascribes to the early disciples a conception of themselves as dedicated to God, in an archaic religious sense, rather than anything that we should call a distinctively ethical reforming direction. If this view is right, there can be no ground for attributing to Jesus himself any peculiar stress on an advanced ethical teaching. The period that lies before Paulinism is left, therefore, somewhat vague. Professor von Manen, in fact, keeps, for the most part, rigorously to his own problem the origins of Paulinism, merely providing himself with such an outline of the earlier growth of Christianity as seems hypothetically sufficient. That this outline furnishes a sufficient hypothesis, I quite agree. A teacher to whom nothing can be authentically attributed but some undefined impulse on a succession of disciples, who afterwards put together from Hebrew sources the body of ethical and religious sayings, which we call the teaching of Jesus, might conceivably, when his name was brought into a different social medium and he was personally forgotten, grow into the supernatural Christ of the Pauline school. If, however, we are to inquire resolutely into the origins of Christianity from the beginning, the question must be put, is the hypothesis necessary as well as sufficient? the result of further consideration has been to convince me that it is not. I accept the conclusion recently set forth by Mr. J. M. Robertson, in a trilogy of able works, that the gospel story is, to all intents and purposes, not merely legendary, but mythical. Mr. Robertson's thesis, it seems to me, can even be carried further. He, too, has stopped short, as he points out that earlier critics have done, through not questioning the ecclesiastical tradition radically enough. He concedes that Christianity, as a distinctive sect, may have arisen about the time when it arose according to the authorized view of the Church, that is to say, in the generation preceding the destruction of Jerusalem. He holds, indeed, that at that time it was no more than a Jewish sect, though here Paulinism, if the epistles attributed to Paul and implying his activity are genuine, would be at least an anomaly. Professor von Manen's investigations, however, remove this difficulty, for his thesis can be perfectly well combined with Mr. Robertson's. This done, I contend that we must take an additional step in the negative direction. Before the fall of the temple, we must assume nothing at all corresponding to Christianity except an obscure cult, the evidence for which Mr. Robertson has done much to bring to light, and an indeterminate messianic movement. The quasi-historical life and death of Jesus, around which a new sect or sects came to cohere, did not take form till after the year 70. The period of gestation, of oral myth-making, lasted till about the end of the first century. Then began the production of the New Testament literature, without exception pseudepigraphic, which was approximately completed by the middle of the second century. Anyone to whom these conclusions may seem startling will do well to read in the light of them Kant's Religion Within the Bounds of Bare Reason, where their general drift may be found philosophically anticipated. It is clear not only that Kant had studied the New Testament with that close attention which Matthew Arnold regretted that Hume had not seen fit to give it, but that he had come to entirely negative conclusions, equally as regards the tradition embodied in the books and the tradition about them. He says distinctly that no historical value can be attached to the statements of Christian literature for the period before Christianity had a learned and critical public of its own, and that it had no such public till it emerged into the general life of the Roman Empire. And in detail, he deliberately refrains from committing himself to the supposition that there is any historical basis whatever for the legends he may use incidentally as the text for a religious philosophy. These are treated as simply what the society that was building up the new cosmopolitan religion desired to have believed by the faithful. His position that, in the total absence of real evidence, we are at liberty to devise the best interpretation we can of Christian doctrine and teaching, so as to carry Christianity forward to the stage of a purely rational and ethical religion, could only seem permissible in a time less preoccupied with historical problems than our own. The century that followed Kant, instead of putting aside such problems as irrelevant to a rational construction, threw itself with new zeal into investigations of the embryology of institutions. The results cannot, in the long run, be without bearing on the practical attitude of the world to existing religions. I hope the pages which follow may be of service towards the traditional task of English philosophy, that of clearing the ground a little for the scientific cultivators of the field. my exposition of Professor von Manen is based on his great work Paulus, of which the three parts are 1. De Handelingen der Apostelen, from 1890, 2. De Brief an de Romeinen, from 1891, and 3. De Brieven an de Corinthiers, from 1896. I have added a few notes, of which some, however, are only transferences of the more detailed evidence from the original text. Occasional reference is also made to the short Handleiding wurde aus christlicher Letterkunde, from 1900. As the exposition of Part 2 was written independently of Professor von Manen's article on Romans in the Encyclopaedia Biblica, Volume 4, the two accounts should supplement one another. The introductory essay is an attempt to do more explicitly what biblical critics themselves do concurrently with their analytical work, namely, to deduce the order of events in outline according to the results reached by examination of the documents. My method has been to take the destruction of Jerusalem in the year 70, the consciousness of which pervades all the old Christian literature, as the presupposition of the development. Thus we are at the point of view of historical causation. The analysis having shown that all the documents are considerably posterior to the great catastrophe of Judaism, the synthesis ought to show how this was precisely the event which we must select as the cause, or as the indispensable occasion, of the peculiar conflux of elements that came together in the Christian Church. End of preface. Introduction, chapters 1 through 3 of The Origins of Christianity by Thomas Whittaker. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Introduction, The Origins of Christianity, Chapter 1, Biblical Criticism and Its Verification. Critical analysis of the Hebrew Scriptures has resolved them, for the most part, into a stratification of pseudepigraphic documents. This is a general character not only of the religious literature of the East, but also of the incipient stages of our Western literature. We even find something like it in the scientific and philosophical textbooks of later classical antiquity, though here the character is that of straightforward compilation. There is no false ascription of authorship to saints and sages of old times. It must, therefore, always be remembered that, in applying the ancient and modern European norm of individual authorship to an Oriental religious literature, we are more likely to be wrong than right. The Quran, which undoubtedly proceeded from a known person, Muhammad, is an exceptional case among the books that have been made the foundation of the Eastern religions, that is, of all the great historic religions. Although the New Testament was written in Greek at a time long after individual authorship had become the norm in Greek literature, it clearly belongs to the Oriental type. Its ideas spring directly out of an Oriental religion, and the literature that immediately preceded it in its own line, that is, the later Jewish apocryphal literature with messianic aspirations, is admitted to be entirely pseudepigraphic. It is worth noting that religious or semi-religious literature in the West also has tended to this type. Take the case of the Orphic poems and of a large part of the compositions put forth by the Neo-Pythagorean school. The cultivated Greek mind, however, was critical in our sense of the term. It really cared to know whether a composition was by its alleged author, not merely whether it was edifying. Hence, While modern criticism has been able to go further, ancient criticism had already detected the true character of much of this literature. When Iamblichus, writing in so credulous an age as the 4th century of our era, apologized for what some thought deception on the part of the Neopythagoreans, the state of the case was evidently well known, and his apology was exactly that of some modern Europeans, who have found it a merit in Eastern authors not to make so much of their individuality as we do, not to put forward any personal claim for their thought. He argued that the procedure was to be commended as a sign of modesty. If we could be perfectly impartial, no doubt we should neither praise nor blame, but simply recognize that it is a mode of authorship normal in a different intellectual environment. When a literature which has arisen in this way has become the basis of a great religion, especially of a religion still accepted in our time and country, the difficulties of the critic are, of course, increased. More stringent proof of the pseudepigraphic character of Moses is required than of Orpheus. The opponent of destructive criticism can hold to the formal possibility that the writings may belong to the time supposed, even if the weight of the inductive evidence is against it. He can safely challenge the critic to produce the original manuscripts of the superimposed documents. It is evident that verification cannot be sought along this line. What, then, is the true method of verification, that which must at length carry general conviction if scientific culture does not relapse to a lower stage? It is no other than the historical or inverse deductive method formulated by Comte and Mill. A generalization is made inductively from the facts of history. Then it is deduced by showing how the sequence of events was necessitated according to known laws of human nature. In the special case of biblical criticism, a certain chronological order of books and portions of books, different from that traditionally assigned, is inferred from analysis, linguistic, and other. This order and the sequence of historical facts derived from it is then shown to make the process of history naturally or rationally intelligible, as the traditional account does not. By a method of which this is fundamentally the character, a conviction of the truth of what is called the higher criticism, so far as it relates to the Old Testament, has already been brought home to most of the minds that can be got to attend to it. The more ingenious and obstinate traditionalists say to the higher critics, "But you beg the question. You assume the absolute uniformity of nature. You will not allow any explanation that is not from natural causes. We, on the other hand, believe in supernatural interferences with the course of nature. Now we defy you to disprove a miracle by formal logic. Till you can reduce us to self-contradiction, we hold to the tradition of the religion in which we have been brought up. And, as you see, we can do this without abandoning the use of reasoning. To insist that we must admit everywhere iron laws of nature is, out of scientific prejudice, to refuse us the right to prove our case, even if there should be actual exceptions to natural law." To this, the reply is that, of course, scientific method assumes the uniformity of nature, but that it does not absolutely exclude proof of miracles if they occurred. Suppose that in certain regions of time and space, the assumption of uniformity now and then led us astray, that we ran against empirical facts which reduced it to nonsense at certain points. Then we should have to reconsider the question of its universal validity. Suppose, for example, that a priesthood affirms certain events not naturally explicable, and that we meet with specific confirmations of them which stand out from the mass of facts we can explain. Let us put the case that to reason from natural knowledge has led to manifest error about the formation of the earth or the events of Egyptian history. Whereas an account declared to be supernaturally revealed is supported by unexpected discoveries and enables us to think the order of events with logical coherence, provided we dismiss the scientific prejudice in favor of uniformity. This would oblige us to reconsider our position, or at any rate, to search for unknown laws. But how different, in the case in question, is the real state of affairs? To point to the issue of the conflict between the quasi-scientific assertions in cosmology, in geology, in ancient history, to which theologians have committed themselves, and the unbroken career of science, almost savors of a past age. How a religion basing itself from the beginning on such assertions can live without them is not yet revealed. But we are to understand that the Church no longer insists upon anything that can by any possibility come into conflict with verified science. And we are to forget that it ever did. We need not further trouble ourselves about apologetics grounded on an imaginary claim to have given a verifiable account of the universe. In fact, critical science has made just as triumphant progress as physical science. The postulate that the history of the Jews, like that of other races, is rationally explicable by natural causes has led to constantly increased insight. From Spinoza in the 17th century to Wellhausen in the 19th, the movement has been comparable to any other scientific movement that can be named. Spinoza was successful in breaking down the supernaturalist assumptions by analysis, but he did not put forth a constructive theory which could give permanent satisfaction. He took the idea of the Hebrew commonwealth too statically, reasoning as if a society fundamentally of the same type had existed all along. Modern criticism at length found the true solution in placing the realization of the type, so far as it ever was realized, at the end, and explaining it by development, under special circumstances, from a primordial state of things that was far less determinate. Those who redacted their sacred books during that late stage of the national life, which we call the theocracy, drew back their ideal into the past, ascribed the final legislative code to a supposed early lawgiver, Moses, to whom the law had been divinely revealed, and, with a view to edification, attributed all the errors and misfortunes of the people to deviation from the imaginary revealed code placed at the beginning. In this process, however, the late redactors did not wholly rewrite the earlier records on which they worked. Portions of the oldest Hebrew literature lie embedded as fragments with a newer structure around them. This mode of composition, carried on sometimes for a considerable length of time, has led to the existence of historical books, not merely of two, but of many strata, each new stratum involving modifications in the history, according as the kind of edification aimed at varied from period to period. The more or less archaic fragments, the words of which had been preserved to a certain extent unmodified as already sacred, gave valuable clues to criticism, which could thus disentangle the extremely complex structure and, within limits, explain the process by which it arrived at the form in which it was fixed. This being the character of the Old Testament as literature and history, we should expect similar phenomena in the case of the New Testament, which is its direct descendant. And, a little later, critics are arriving at an equally thoroughgoing rejection of the tradition under which it has long been presented. What seems probable is that we shall find the teaching ascribed to the founder of the new religion and his apostles to be a result of gradual growth thrown back in imagination to the beginning, like the ideal of the ancient theocracy. The question is, will this hypothesis rationally explain the phenomena of stratification detected in the books by analysis? For undoubtedly, the books do present such phenomena. They are not unitary compositions like those of a Greek or Roman historian, or even romancer. It will help to clear up the problem if we return to the history of the Hebrews and try to set forth in brief outline some general results of criticism. 2. The Church State of Judea. The Jewish theocracy, as it is called, that is, the direction of life by a priesthood speaking in the name of God and appealing to sacred books, was established under the Persian supremacy many years after the chiefs of the nation had been exiled to Babylonia on the conquest of Judea by Nebuchadnezzar. The exiles, who, in the meantime, had come in contact with the civilization of the new Babylonian Empire, must have been considerably influenced by it. Continuous as it was with the immensely long tradition represented by the Assyrian and Old Babylonian monarchies, it stood for a far more elaborate system of life and thought than their own. The extent of the obligation has been partly made out by recent discoveries, but it is yet too early for definitive results to be stated. When the Babylonian dominion had given place to that of the kings of Persia, certain priestly reformers, inheriting the ideals of the prophetic movement that had preceded the exile, and had gained some transitory political successes in Judea, were allowed to rebuild the temple of the national god and to remodel the nation as a church. From this and the following period dates not only the redaction of all the sacred literature, but the original composition of a great part of it. If the attempt is made to trace the history of the Hebrews before this time, the condition of the documents puts many difficulties in the way, but it is historically certain that from the 9th century BC, they had been divided into two kingdoms, the northern kingdom of Israel and the southern kingdom of Judah. The former was overthrown by the Assyrian power near the end of the 8th century. The latter had survived to the beginning of the 6th. An undivided Kingdom of Israel, described as having existed earlier, had probably been ruled in succession by the two biblical kings, David and Solomon. The accounts of them, however, are much embellished, and this portion of the record has not yet been confirmed by the monuments of the great empires then existing. It has been conjectured that about the 12th century BC, the Israelites formed part of a group of desert tribes, making incursions on the cultivated land of Canaan. These tribes, having conquered territories for themselves, took to a settled life, and by degrees formed the nationalities we know as Israel, Edom, Moab, and Ammon. Anything earlier than this is legendary or altogether mythical. On the borders between Palestine and Egypt, Semitic tribes, the kindred of the Israelites, were from time to time subject to the Egyptian government. But there is nothing whatever to confirm the story with which we are familiar of the captivity of Israel in Egypt and the Exodus under Moses. When we go back to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and the 12 patriarchs, we find ourselves in a region of mythical figures turned to literary account, perhaps of old Semitic gods brought down to mortality. The effective beginnings of the literature scarcely date from an earlier period than the 9th century. From this period come the most archaic portions of the early books. The Israelites were originally polytheists, like the surrounding tribes, but like the others, they had their own tribal god. The God of Israel was at first worshipped with rites, like those of Semitic heathenism generally. He was represented sometimes by an image in the form of a man or of an ox. Under the name of the king, Molech, he was propitiated in times of national calamity by rites of human sacrifice, as was also Chemosh, the god of the kindred Moabites, and the Carthaginian deity whom the Greeks called Kronos. Among the Hebrews, however, there arose in the 8th century the reformers described as prophets. They claimed to speak in the name of Jehovah, as the God of Israel has long been called in European literature, denounced many immoral and inhuman cults as contrary to his will, and more especially aimed at the extirpation of idolatry, that is, the representation of Jehovah by any kind of image. He was preeminently a jealous God who would endure no other divinities beside him. Intolerance of other worships was, for the Israelite, a sacred duty. Of the kings who had not rigorously practiced it, but had allowed foreign cults in their dominions, altogether they might worship Jehovah first. It was said later that they did evil in the sight of the Lord. The higher minds among the prophets succeeded at length, how early or how late it is difficult to say, in arriving at an ethical monotheism. Jehovah was the God of the universe. There was no other God. He rewarded righteousness and punished iniquity. He asked not for sacrifice. This conception, it should be needless to point out, was never realized in the public religion. The actual achievement of the prophets was, by forming an alliance with the priests of Jerusalem, to centralize the worship, to put down irregular local cults, and to get rid of graven images. By the returning exiles from the 6th to the 5th century BC, the national monarchy having disappeared, the state was identified with the Congregation of the Lord. Pure theocracy was henceforth the ideal. A most elaborate system of sacrifice and ceremonial observance was established, and was declared in the name of Moses to be for all time. Jehovah was identified, as the higher prophets had identified him, with the God of the universe. But he remained, essentially, an invisible king to be recognized by the state, demanding at the hands of his chosen people a perpetual service of bloodshed and burnt offering. Nevertheless, an interest in questions of moral conduct went on apart from the sacrificial cult. There it was proposed to solve by application of the law. There arose what has been called a system of legal dialectic. The characteristic Jewish institution of the synagogue appeared. In the rabbinic schools, there seems to have been relative freedom of moral and religious life, analogous to that of Protestantism. The reforming movement, with its stress on the inward disposition, had not been in vain. Private judgment could be used in interpreting the sacred texts. The hierarchy did not grow into an anti-human organization for the repression of thought. The conception of heresy had not yet been evolved. An elaborate cult was still unaccompanied by an elaborate creed. The deepest questions about human destiny might be put freely, and unshrinking discussion of them was admitted in books that came to be regarded as sacred. As time went on, the priestly families displayed tendencies to the type of a secular aristocracy. Among their members were afterwards the skeptical Sadducees. When Judea, through the fall of the Persian Empire, came under the dominion of the Greek kings of Syria, it needed a national uprising to prevent the hierarchs themselves, rather than the foreign king, from Hellenizing their religion and institutions. The contest was fought out, in the 2nd century BC, between the ideals of a polished decadence and of exclusive theocracy, and the latter triumphed. Under the Maccabees, national independence was won, though only to be lost again as the dissolution of Alexander's world empire made way for the advance of Rome. Meanwhile, the distinctive line of spiritual life which the nation had marked out for itself was followed to new issues. 3. Post-biblical eschatology of the Jews. A famous work of the Maccabean Age marks the transition to a new epoch. The Book of Daniel was written to encourage the pious Jews in their resistance to the Hellenizing movement, started from within, but taken in hand with violent caprice by the Seleucid king Antiochus Epiphanes. The composition was attributed to the seer Daniel, a supposed Jewish exile in Babylon 400 years before the date of the book. Much in it that purports to be prophecy is therefore an account of past events in symbolical form. It became the model of all later apocalypses, both for Jews and Christians. Pseudo-Daniel was not received into the number of the Jewish prophetic books, but only into the class of writings known as hagiographa. The earliest critic to detect its real character was the philosopher Porphyry in his extensive work against the Christians, known to us now only by the references of ecclesiastical writers. Renan has described the Book of Daniel as a first attempt at a philosophy of history. The Jews, he remarks, were in a central position among the great empires, acted as intermediaries, and could observe their transformations from an external point of view. Thus, they were prepared to see a general direction of the world movement and to search for its law. The later apocalypses, with all their supernatural machinery, have something of the same wide outlook. The law of history, according to Daniel, is clearly the successive dissolution of the kingdoms of this world, to give place at last to the universal theocracy foretold by the prophets. And the dream was in a manner fulfilled, though not by the Jews, not to their advantage, and not with the idyllic effect anticipated in some of the prophecies. When their kingdom of God came, it brought not peace but a sword. There are indeed prophecies, with the tone of which this was quite in unison. But in many there prevails the hope that the nations will at length feel the attraction of the pure religion revealed to Israel, and will voluntarily submit themselves to its ordinances. Israel is conceived as having for destiny to be a priesthood for the human race, and efforts were made in both directions. While peaceful proselytism was constantly going on, there was no scruple about making war on neighboring peoples in a religious interest. During the time of Jewish independence, the heathen inhabitants of Galilee were subjected and converted to the temple worship by force. What, in general, was looked for, however, was a catastrophic change brought to pass without human volition, as part of the design of God with the world. In the later period, the kingdom of God on earth was usually conceived as established by the Messiah, the anointed king, a figure derived from various passages in the prophets, and not of wholly consistent attributes. Among the current imaginations were those of a Messiah ben David, who was to be triumphant, and of a Messiah ben Joseph, who was to suffer. Occasionally, also in the apocalyptic writers, there is no deputed king or Messiah at all. God rules directly. Traces of an anti-monarchical, theocratic feeling, like that of the Puritans, as we may learn from the canonical books themselves, were not unknown to the Jews. The suffering Messiah combined the ideas of the just man struggling with adversity and of the holy people persecuted by the heathen for adherence to the one true God. Both these modes of suffering had forced themselves as facts on the Jewish mind and had contributed to modify the prevalent ideas on the destiny of the soul, which, apart from external influences, seems to have undergone changes curiously parallel with those that went forward in a similarly spontaneous manner in Greece. As is well known, there is, in the great period of Hebrew literature and religion, practically nothing that has reference to personal immortality. The prophetic writers hold that the problem of divine justice finds its complete solution in earthly life, national or individual. It is not that they had consciously dismissed that animism which is man's first conception of the source of individual life and thought. In the archaic portions of the Bible, there is sufficient evidence that the Hebrews were not exceptional in their early ideas. They too had the notion of the soul as a kind of breath or shadow. They had their Sheol for departed souls, as the Greeks had their Hades. The religious reform of the prophets, however, was not specially concerned with this. Jehovah was the God, not of the dead, but of the living, like the Olympian gods of Greece. Ideals of righteousness were to be realized and to find their justification on earth. There is no reason to suppose, however, that the notion of a permanent individuality, or even of its manifestation as a ghost, ever disappeared from the popular mind. Just as in Greece, this played a larger part in the general religion that could be inferred from Homer or Sophocles, so no doubt in Judea it went on unaffected by the silence of the prophetic literature. Thus, when the theodicy of the prophets, under stress of the facts of Israel's destiny, was felt to have broken down, religious thinkers were able to recur to the animistic idea in order to redress the balance by visions of a future life. Though the parallel with Greece does not altogether fail in this last stage, yet the differences are more conspicuous than the resemblances. In Judea, there was a far more decided influence of what we should call the practical religion. Ethical aspirations did not, indeed, suggest the thought of survival. It was already there, but they were the motives that set thinkers to work on the problem. And the small part that metaphysics played in the process is seen in the form which the expectation of survival usually took, namely, that of a resurrection of the body. In the Jewish apocalyptic literature, the future bodily resurrection of the dead was associated with the coming of the Messiah. When the predicted deliverer has established the kingdom, overthrowing all who resist him among the nations, the dead will rise again and join the faithful Israelites who are alive at his coming. It is not inconsistent with this, which is the general imagination, that the messianic kingdom should be pictured as enduring on earth. That kingdom is, of course, the theocracy universalized. Jerusalem is its center, and all enemies are put under the feet of its anointed king. In the resurrection, sometimes, only the righteous have part. Sometimes the wicked also are raised up to be punished along with the living enemies of the Messiah. By some visionaries, the fate of the heathen at the resurrection is passed over in silence. By others, they are included, as a matter of course, among the wicked. the agent of punishment, sometimes of destruction, is the fire of Gehenna. Though of different origin as imagery, it corresponds in conception with the Tartarus, which, through a mixture of ethical ideas with the primitive, more indeterminate notion of the future, had come to be regarded by the Greeks and Romans as a place of retribution for crimes that had escaped judgment in this life. We have now evidently reached a state of the spiritual atmosphere which explains much in the Gospel, but there are still some further preliminaries. End of Introduction, Chapters 1 through 3. Introduction, Chapters 4 through 5 of The Origins of Christianity by Thomas Whittaker. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Introduction, The Origins of Christianity. Chapter 4, Alexandrian Judaism. The rather unspeculative, though not unimaginative, character of these ideas need not be attributed to any peculiarity of the Semitic as distinguished from the Aryan race. Indeed, it is not unlikely that they were in part the result of contact with Aryan Persia. Their development is sufficiently explained by the circumstances of the Palestinian Jews. Among the Jews of the dispersion, those of Alexandria, who had opportunities of coming in contact with Greek philosophy, showed no intrinsic want of aptitude for metaphysics. Philo, their most eminent representative, was an able thinker, though trammeled, like our Western scholastics of the Middle Age, by the necessity of limiting himself where revealed religion has spoken. If there was no such living coercive authority to check him, he personally desired to remain a faithful adherent to the Mosaic law. He was at work during the early years of the Christian era, but the movement he represents can be traced back, like the production of the apocalyptic literature, to at least the 2nd century BC. When Hebrew religion and Greek philosophy met, some degree of interest could not fail to be aroused on both sides. We know more about the impression made on the Jews. The thinkers among them perceived that some among the Greeks had attained to as pure ideas of divinity as their own. To the original contact with Greek thought must be ascribed, indeed, the beginnings of the effort to explain away those anthropomorphisms in the Bible which were a scandal to Jewish and Christian theologians, till the higher criticism shifted the problem. What is known as the wisdom literature is already touched by the Greek spirit. Philo's historical significance is due to his strenuous effort of reconciliation on the same line. In elaborating, with the aid of his philosophical learning, the half-personalized abstractions called wisdom or spirit or word, through which the transcendent God of Platonizing Judaism could be conceived as acting on matter, he provided Christian speculators an advance with their conception of the Logos. The difference is that, for Philo, the personality of the Logos, or mediating word, could be set aside when he was in a less mythological mood and more anxious to agree with the philosophers. It took its start not from interest in an actual person or a concrete myth, but from more or less conscious philosophical mythologizing to meet certain difficulties of a monotheistic creed. But if Israel had received its monotheism by divine revelation, how was the attainment of the same conviction by heathen philosophers to be explained? To admit that it could be attained by natural light would make revelation superfluous, or would place the chosen people on an inferior level. In the absence of philological science, it was easy to devise an explanation. The Pentateuch, as everyone knew, was of primeval antiquity. The Greek philosophers, it was equally well known, had all borrowed their systems from the East. Evidently, then, the Mosaic revelation, or some fragments of it, had been communicated to Plato and Aristotle. This was, in its way, a liberal view. It permitted the pious Israelite to read and appreciate the books of the heathen. The more open-minded of the Christian fathers, in their turn, found it very convenient, and as late as the 17th century it was still quite alive. In any case, the knowledge that the educated portion of the heathen world, so far as it was religious at all, was permeated with a philosophical theology not unlike that which could be stated as the essence of their own religion, furnished the cosmopolitan Jews with an excellent opening for proselytizing. The claim could be made to instruct the multitude authoritatively in a wisdom long recognized by the few in their own lands. Besides, the Jews came from the East, to which the peoples of the West were accustomed to look as the home of esoteric mysteries. One form which proselytism took was, accordingly, the writing of those Greek compositions in verse known as the Sibylline Oracles. The Cumaean, or some other Sibyl, was represented as proclaiming the superiority of the Jewish religion to all others, the falsity of idols, and the identity of the God of the Jews with the God of the universe. Beyond their pure theism, the Sibylline books contained messianic elements. Hence, they came to be much appealed to on behalf of Christianity. For which reason, Celsus, in his True Word addressed to the Christians, gave them the name of Sibylists. The appeal to the Greek-speaking world was much facilitated by the Septuagint translation of the Bible, which had proceeded from Alexandria. At the opening of the Christian era, Hebrew existed only as a learned language. The language of Palestine was Aramaic, and the scriptures, for popular use, needed interpretation into it. Among the Greek-speaking Jews of the Roman Empire, the Septuagint was the version in use. Thus, there could be put into the hands of proselytes an authorized collection of literature containing the very revelation which, as their new instructors would tell them, they vainly sought in the mysteries of Phrygia or of Egypt. No other religion could offer them the sacred books of an ancient and still living priesthood translated into the vernacular. 5. The preparation for the gospel. Hopeful as the outlook may have appeared for great conquests of the religion of Israel over the old religions of the Mediterranean world, it was not pure Judaism that was to profit by the situation. The reasons that have ordinarily been assigned for this by Christian apologists are sufficient on the whole, though they lead to unexpected conclusions. But first, it may be premised that Hebrew religion had nothing to teach the philosophic schools. Probably the verdict of any religious-minded Platonist would have differed little from that of Julian, that the prophets had indeed, by narrowing their vision for all else, caught a glimpse of one great truth, the unity of directive power in the universe, but that in their expression of it there was more of fire than of light. If any distinct influence could have found access to classical culture, it was on the aesthetic side, and the treatise On the Sublime suffices to prove that a critic with academical standards was not insensitive to the peculiar quality of Hebrew literature. On the side of thought, it was the Jews who underwent influence. With the establishment of amicable relations between Jew and Greek, in a world of continued speculative freedom, this influence would no doubt have gone further. the personality of Jehovah even might have been merged in a pantheistic conception, as it tended to be among small groups of the heterodox in the Middle Ages. This, however, would scarcely have affected the multitude, and it is with the fortunes of popular religion that we are at present concerned. For the many, it is usually said, Judaism had, on the one hand, too much the character of an abstract monotheism, while, on the other hand, it was too stringent in its demand for the observance of a minute ritual. And, of course, proselytes from among the heathen could not feel any deep interest in those discussions of the law which were a delight to the pious Pharisee. To become an adept in them would have required a training as difficult in its way as that of the Hellenic schools. But new religions appealed precisely to those who found the path of philosophy arduous. Above all, a pathetic religion was needed. Who was to take the place of the slain and suffering divinities already introduced from the mystic East, of Dionysus and Adonis and Attis and Osiris, of the sorrowing Isis and of Cybele, the mother of the gods? Could Judea, in fashions unknown to its doctors of the law, offer any such objects of devotion? And could that high tone of authority also be retained, which was assumed by proselytizers orthodox in their own national monotheistic religion, who claimed to teach as a divine revelation what had been for the wisest among the Greeks, at best, a result of fallible human reasoning? The former question, as we know, was solved by the emergence of a cult directed to the crucified Son of God. The latter was solved by the destruction of the temple at Jerusalem. The old hierarchy thus overthrown, the way was left clear for a new one to claim the succession to its authority. Such a hierarchy was formed among the groups of societies practicing the cult, and it displayed the requisite vigor and adaptiveness. It soon had sacred books of its own, which it appended to the older scriptures. The generalized ideas of official Judaism, the messianic hope, Hellenistic myth and ritual, ethical and metaphysical ideas that had passed into currency, and, in particular, the idea of personal salvation in a future life, were all in due proportion assimilated. A new religion had appeared, which at length succeeded in imposing itself in the Roman Empire. By what process did it first emerge? Was the slain god originally a human person, an ethical teacher put to death by the procurator of Judea to appease the Jewish authorities whom his teaching had offended? Did he first, from a prophet or rabbi with a group of disciples, come to be regarded as the Messiah, and then afterwards, on non-Jewish ground, receive full apotheosis? Was the cult, as well as the mythology, thus an accretion, in small part Jewish, in large part Hellenistic, that gathered around an actual human being who was deified? A majority of non-traditionalist critics would probably answer these questions in the affirmative. There is, however, a dissentient minority. Before deciding, we must ask first what evidence there is for the historical events assumed to be recorded in the New Testament. Then, if we find that there is no real evidence, we must go on to ask, in the second place, whether the beginnings of the Christian Church can be explained without supposing its story of Christ to have a basis of fact. Now, the Gospels, to which the primary appeal has to be made, cannot be regarded as historical documents. They are of unknown authorship and of composite origin. their probable date is more than two generations after the events they professedly record, and they are of miracle stories all compact. The teacher never appears as a mere human being, but as the Lord, the Son of God. His birth is miraculous. His death on the cross is not described with accompaniments that were those of a Roman execution, but with the characteristic details of various rites of human sacrifice known in all parts of the world from India to Mexico. To all of them a mystic significance is attributed. As a teacher, he from the first claims authority to reverse the decisions of the ancient lawgiver of his nation. If he approves of the law, that too is by his authority. We are remote enough here from memoirs of someone who really lived. Is there, then, any external evidence pointing to some nucleus of actual occurrence? The answer must be that there is none whatever. The only apparent exception is the celebrated passage in the Annals of Tacitus, Book 15, Section 44. This passage itself, indeed, defies all skepticism, yet on every side it has been found puzzling. It only becomes clear by the admission that, in the period to which it refers, there was as yet no Christianity in our sense of the term, that is, no belief in a Christ who was said to have appeared at a definite place and time. The account is briefly this. To divert from himself the suspicion of having caused the great fire at Rome in the year 64, for the sake of his ambitious architectural schemes, the Emperor Nero accused those who were commonly called Christians. Christus, the author of that name, had been put to death in the reign of Tiberius by Pontius Pilatus, the procurator. The dire superstition, repressed for a moment, burst forth again and spread from Judea, the original seat of the evil, to Rome itself. Inquiries being now instituted with reference to the conflagration, a vast multitude was in the end seized. The accused were convicted, not so much of having caused the fire, as of hatred of the human race. Their punishment was of Neronian atrocity, so that, in spite of the guilt imputed to them, compassion arose for their fate, since it was felt that their sufferings had been inflicted not for the public good, but to satiate the cruelty of one man. A difficulty in this account is the absolute want of plausibility of such a charge against the early Christians of legend. The commentators have pointed out that it would have been much more plausible against apocalyptic Jewish fanatics, and the suggestion has been made that the real Christians were somehow mixed up with these, who formed the chief portion of the vast multitude. On this hint, let us put the extreme hypothesis that there were no Christians at all in our sense, and that there could not be, because the author of the sect was mythical, and the circumstantial form of the myth had not then arisen. We shall find that every statement of Tacitus falls spontaneously into its place. Christians, as we understand the term, existed, of course, in the time of the historian himself, who was writing under Trajan early in the second century. It is to their faith that he applied his memorable phrase. Having been a Roman official, he would know or suspect something of the close and authoritative organization of the rising church, and he may have heard rumors as to the damnatory character of its creed. The almost colorless statement about the founder, he would naturally take from what was repeated in common by the Christians of his own day. He would see no reason for rejecting the assertion that the author of a new sect, presumably anti-Roman, had suffered under Pontius Pilate, a procurator detested by the nationalist Jews. To suppose that he may have derived the information from the Roman archives is perfectly gratuitous. He was trying to get at the history of the sect by the procedure known to students of sources as combination. Here is no testimony to the crucifixion, independent of the Christian belief, which, in the same age, was incorporated in the Gospels. But why should Christians be spoken of as existing in the time of Nero? And what is the historical basis of the account? There is no difficulty about the answer. By no other name could Greeks or Romans speak of messianic Jews. Now we know that soon after the date of the Great Fire, the revolt of Judea broke out, which was suppressed by Vespasian and Titus. It may reasonably be inferred from Suetonius, Claudius, section 25, that the tumults he mentions as having gone on among the Jews of Rome earlier were associated with messianic movements. We know also the type of apocalyptic expectations current among the messianists. At the coming of the anointed king from the east, the secular world state was to be dissolved amid slaughter and universal conflagration, over which the saints of the theocracy would everlastingly exult. When the Jewish community everywhere was seething with preludes of insurrection set going by these hopes, who could be more speciously accused of incendiarism than those among them by whom the Messiah, the Christ, was most vividly expected? And would not the beliefs about the end of all things, which they would confidently express, bring them, in the eyes of the heathen, who were to be destroyed, under what might seem justified charge of hatred of the human race, even if it should be made clear that they were falsely accused of setting fire to the city? That a vast multitude of apocalyptic Jews, including perhaps Greek-speaking proselytes, could be arrested in Rome, then largely of foreign population, there is no reason to doubt. So that, if the real victims of Nero were fanatical Jews, the historian need not be accused of exaggerating. With this view, the small amount of reference made for a long time by church writers to the so-called Neronian persecution is in harmony. They knew nothing of it from their own tradition, and, when they came to speak of it, merely transmitted the understandings of Tacitus, who, from the identity of name, had confused the messianists of Nero's time with the new sect of Christians in the time of Trajan. Still, though there is nothing that can be called historical evidence for the existence of a personal Christ whose name was adored by a group of believers as early as the reign of Nero, may not the hypothesis be necessary to explain the legend? The Gospels assign his appearance to the reign of Tiberius and to the procuratorship of Pontius Pilate. Cannot this information have been correctly preserved by oral transmission till the accounts were written down early in the second century? I had thought that some such view might be defended, but partly by the arguments of Mr. Robertson, and partly by confirmation of them since met with, I have been led to a different conclusion. The real basis of the Christian community, I take to have been, as Mr. Robertson holds, a cult which was connected with a Jesus or Joshua long since conceived as of divine status. The story of a quasi-historic Jesus grew out of immemorial elements of native Semitic ritual and myth, which now rose to the surface after ages of obscure persistence beneath the official and Pharisaic Jewish religion. To form the definite myth, this story, combined with Hellenistic stories of similar type, itself undergoing modification in the process. Elements of what is called heathenism are, of course, to be detected in the canonical Hebrew scriptures. Julian had no difficulty in proving this against the claim that, as a whole, they taught an absolutely pure monotheism. He could even show that the devil worship, of which the Jews and the Christians after them were fond of accusing the nations, was not absent in their own documents. His interpretation of the scapegoat, sacrificed to Azazel, has been confirmed by modern critical science. Thus, there is no paradox if we find in apocryphal or Christian books still more distinct traces of lingering polytheism. A particular confirmation of Mr. Robertson's view, to which I desire to draw attention, is an older reading in the Epistle of Jude, recognized in the margin of the Revised Version. It occurs in verse 5, and its significance is brought out by verse 6. "I will therefore put you in remembrance, though ye once knew this, how that Jesus, having saved the people out of the land of Egypt the second time, afterward destroyed them that believed not." The next verse proceeds, "And the angels which kept not their first estate, but left their own habitation, he hath reserved in everlasting chains under darkness unto the judgment of the great day." Plainly, the binding of erring angels can only be attributed to a supernatural being and not to a mere national hero. And it must be remembered that the epistle is a Judeo-Christian, not a heathen Christian work. With this passage from a book of the New Testament, it is interesting to compare a messianic prophecy from the Sibylline Oracles, translated by the Reverend W. J. Dean, as follows. "Now a certain excellent man shall come again from heaven, who spread forth his hands upon the very fruitful tree, the best of the Hebrews, who once made the sun stand still, speaking with beauteous words and pure lips." Here, as Mr. Robertson would say, we observe the conception passing into that of the teaching God. The very fruitful tree, or tree of fair fruit, has reference, of course, to that sacrificial idea of which the implications have been brought out by Mr. Fraser in The Golden Bough. We evidently have here, in the idea already present on Jewish ground, of a believer with divine name and attributes, a possible center of a new growth. This renders superfluous Mr. Fraser's own explanation of the Christian cultus as the starting point of the sacrificial idea into renewed vitality through the death of an actual Jesus, the Galilean teacher, selected, by the machinations of sacerdotal hostility, as the victim of a surviving annual rite at Jerusalem, in which usually a condemned criminal played the part of a dying god. For Mr. Fraser's tentative hypothesis, there can be substituted a combination of the positive results of his great anthropological investigation with the results, negative as well as positive, of biblical criticism. The particular events related in the Gospels did not happen, but, as Mr. Robertson puts it, the story condenses a whole phase, indeed more than one phase, of religion in a single figure. The human victim is crucified as the incarnation of the God. He has the attributes of a corn god and of a wine god. Hence, his body and blood can be partaken of sacramentally by eating bread and drinking wine. He rises again from the dead. His death and resurrection are celebrated annually, at the season when celebrations of the death and new birth of deities, whether representative of the forces of vegetation or of the power of the sun, are usual. With this most archaic conception, according to which the god is slain in his prime so that he may regain his vigor in a new manifestation, a piacular idea is combined. Sinless himself, he was made a sacrifice for the sins of others. His death, therefore, coincides in time with an old piacular rite, the Passover, probably itself derived from a custom of human sacrifice. Then, since the new religion of the incarnate God adopts the sacred books of its predecessor as its own, all other conceptions have to be reconciled with Jewish monotheism. Hence, the problem of Christian theology, handed down from the New Testament to the fathers, and from the fathers to the schoolmen. End of introduction, chapters 4-5. Introduction, chapters 6-7 of The Origins of Christianity by Thomas Whittaker. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Introduction, The Origins of Christianity. Chapter 6, The Destruction of Jerusalem and Its Consequences. But if we accept some view of this kind, the question still remains for decision. When did the cult first draw to itself a new myth in a concrete form? The answer I propose is that it was not until after the destruction of Jerusalem in the year 70. That great crisis unloosed ideas which had long been preparing. We know both from Josephus and from Tacitus that prodigies were reported to have taken place before the fall of the temple. A voice louder than human was heard proclaiming the departure of the gods. But few, says Tacitus, interpreted this in the sense of fear. Most were persuaded that it was contained in the ancient scriptures of the priests that, at that time, the East should wax strong, and that men going forth from Judea should possess the world. Now, these hopes were not abandoned by the Orthodox Jews themselves till long after. The Gentile proselyte to Judaism was still a familiar figure at Rome in the reign of Domitian, and even later, as we may infer from Juvenal, who, it may be noted, at the beginning of the second century, knows nothing of the Christians. It was not until the total annihilation of the Jewish polity in consequence of the revolt suppressed by Hadrian, that the religion retired into the all but complete exclusiveness it has ever since maintained. And by that time, the Orthodox proselytism, reserving as it did for born Israelites the position of a religious aristocracy, had been superseded by that of the Christians, who had gone forth from among them. Thus, it seems probable that, just after the catastrophe of the year 70, those Jews or semi-Jews who, for any reason, were discontented with the hierarchy and the rabbis, would show quite exceptional activity. For they too were penetrated with the national hopes, and the accepted leaders of the people had failed. Let a rumor go forth that the Messiah, who was to suffer and then to triumph, had already appeared and undergone that which was foretold by the prophets. Would not this gain instant credence with many? And here is such basis as may be found for a myth. There was nothing incredible in the assertion that one who had been sent to lead the nation along a new way had been crucified by Pontius Pilate, whose procuratorship was now in the past, and was remembered as a harsh one for the Jews. The name of Jesus, an actual name in Palestine, was destined for the new deliverer as being that of an ancient god transformed into a national leader. Eucharists, partaken of by limited circles, existed among the Jews as elsewhere, and these circles, with their devotion to unofficial mysteries, were likely to retain the most archaic religious ideas. Thus, there was already a cult and organization prepared to receive so congenial a new belief. Enough is known of such confraternities to make it intelligible that extended associations growing out of them should become very powerful. This indeed was one ground for suspicion on the part of the Roman government, not now displayed for the first time. A new proselytizing society, if it could not make its innocence of all far-reaching designs very clear, was sure to find itself classed among unlawful collegia. And, as a matter of fact, no sooner did the conception of the Christian Church as one great organization begin to exist than such designs were inseparable from its life. On the ethical side, it was easy to ascribe to the new deliverer a reformed teaching which some among the best minds, reacting against the superfetation of official ritual and casuistry, desired to educe from the ancient books. Thus might appear the first collections of sayings attributed to Jesus. If this was a comparatively early movement, originating in Palestine, then we can explain the difference between the impression made on a modern liberal Jew by the synoptic Jesus and by the Paul of the Epistles. The teaching, primarily attributed to the founder, represents a phase of moral reflection that was really in contact with the law, and could criticize its shortcomings and those of its expositors with effect. The Pauline writings represent Gentile Christianity, to which the law was an abstraction. For the Pauline groups, the main interest lay in developing the idea of the supernatural Christ in the lines of an incipient theology and soteriology. And this development, as von Manen has shown, was Hellenistic, and was removed at least one stage from the origin of the religion of Jesus. The teaching, so far as it is not disfigured by ecclesiastical accretions, such as the commission to certain persons to forgive sins, and so forth, is that which has conferred on Christianity its attraction for minds, which the dogma leaves unaffected or rouses to revolt. Yet pagan opponents like Celsus were able to prove that, to one who knew the philosophers, it was not fundamentally original. It was not, of course, derived from philosophy. By modern criticism, its derivation from Hebrew sources has been traced. Its notable sayings are, for the most part, to be read word for word in the Old Testament. The exaltation of the poor and oppressed was no new thing, but had long been a distinctive feature of Hebrew literature, so much so that it had modified the connotations of Greek words used in the Septuagint. The Greek classical literature, with its insistence on justice first and foremost, does not dwell so much on the side of conduct which this expresses. Recognitions of it, however, are not wanting, so that the later representatives of the classical spirit could show that kindness to the unfortunate, though in their time, as they admitted, more practiced by Jews and Christians, was, nevertheless, in their own traditions. Any moderns who imagine that the virtue of compassion was invented by Christianity, or even by Hebraism, may be confuted by sayings dating not solely from the cosmopolitan period of Greco-Roman ethics, but from the militant period of the city-state. And here natural feeling is trusted in the last resort. The appeal is not to the authority of a divine person who has commanded men to be humane under the promise of heaven and the threat of hell. The ascetic side of Christianity was hardly at all distinctive till it degenerated into repulsive mockery. Whatever may be thought of the ascetic movement of later antiquity, it was in its origins undoubtedly pagan. Its great representatives were the Neo-Pythagoreans, who included in their ascetic discipline, besides chastity, abstinence from flesh and wine. Their abstinence from flesh had, for one motive, compassionate feeling towards the lower animals. Now this, although not usually carried to the same length, is a part of all modern non-Catholic ethics. But while it may be traced equally in Hebraism and in Hellenism, it gets no special recognition from Christianity. "Doth God take care of oxen?" asks the Apostle of the Gentiles. Around the central figure of the religion, to whom the widened ethical teaching of certain Aramaic-speaking groups may have been first ascribed, there gathered at length all kinds of typical stories of divine teachers. Some of these stories are said to be of Buddhistic origin. What was required of neophytes, however, was not acceptance of the teaching, but belief in the miraculous resurrection of the Lord. There is no vestige of evidence for any early or earliest Christianity that was simply a moral rule of life. The simplest form of faith described in the Christian record is the confession that the Jesus, of whose life and death oral accounts were in circulation, was the Messiah, the Christ. Few of the Hellenistic converts of Syria or Asia Minor, where Christianity gained its first successes, would have had the competence or the desire to investigate such accounts. If any displayed the inclination, they were told that belief without evidence was a virtue. The story, besides, had close affinity with their own religious ideas, and it had been placed in a time before a convulsion deeply affecting all who, practicing less organized cults, looked with awe on the tremendous claims of Judaism. The Messiah of the Jews, it could now be declared in terms of a typical and worldwide myth, had suffered and risen again from the dead. He would return to reward those who believed and to punish unbelievers with destruction. Thus, the old theocratic dream reappeared. The initiates of the emergent cult had no thought of giving up the expectation of universal dominion bequeathed to them, as they held, by their forefathers, natural or spiritual. Their kingdom was not of this world, because, when it came, the world, or the present age, would be destroyed. Their Jerusalem was a new Jerusalem, hence they need not regret of the old. Peaceful and violent theocratic aspirations were mingled, as with their predecessors. By some among them, it was desired that everything should be done by mild persuasion. Others looked forward to plagues and earthquakes and flaming fire. As the Orthodox Jews did not enthusiastically receive the new gospel, or glad tidings, the responsibility for the death of the promised Redeemer began to be cast upon them, and withdrawn as much as possible from the Roman governor. Prophecies of the destruction of Jerusalem and parables prefiguring the rejection of the unbelieving Jews from the promised kingdom were put in the mouth of Jesus. The new sect turned more and more to the Gentiles. The feast is for all, except those men who were first invited. If any are unwilling, the servants of the kingdom must compel them to come in. Jesus, it was held, had sent forth his mystic 12 apostles, corresponding to the 12 patriarchs and the 12 tribes of Israel. He had commissioned them to teach all nations, and had appointed the ceremonies of his religion, in reality, immemorial usages, Jewish and pagan. A story of his betrayal grew up. He had been bought with a price, like the victims of known human sacrifices. A mystery drama came into being, setting forth his crucifixion and resurrection and the associated events. This is the basis of the extant narrative, as is especially evident in our first two Gospels. Hellenistic ritual and mythology, in their remoter origin themselves Asiatic, contributed to the syncretism. The mythical development was accompanied or followed by speculations of a more intellectual kind. In about a generation from the fall of the temple, the way had been prepared for the new movement called Paulinism. To understand the exact position, however, we must go back and consider, in its bearing on the future of religion, the process of development undergone by the ancient classical world till it was confronted with Christianity. 7. The anti-Hellenic reaction. In the West, a new type of civilization had arisen, different from that of Asia. Its characteristics were political self-government as opposed to absolutism, humanist as distinguished from theological culture, and, in tendency, the direction of life by ideas attained through a process of unfettered thought, as opposed to its direction under the traditional system of a priestly hierarchy. No hard and fast division between East and West, indeed, has ever existed grounded in these distinctions, but on the whole they describe the fundamental contrast. The Western type was developed with various degrees of purity by the Greek cities, and afterwards by Rome. Its ideal has by all later generations been found in Athens in the 5th century BC. This ideal was not, of course, realized without imperfections. The representatives, for example, of popular government and of philosophy did not always understand that their causes were united. The progressive movement, besides, was stopped, so that in many ways the humanity and sense of justice displayed even by not extraordinary minds had no chance of coming to fruition. To this period, the ancients themselves looked back as the humanist ideal. Cicero, at the opening of the fifth book of his De Finibus, already treats it as a sacred antiquity, very much as we do ourselves. From the collapse of the Athenian power at the end of the Great Age, the world has never since wholly recovered. That is to say, if we consider not individual men of genius, nor yet mere expansion, but conceptions of life as realized in political societies without reference to their magnitude, the civilization of Renaissance or modern Europe is on a larger scale, but it still remains, even at the height, deeply entangled in the systems that were imposed by reaction from the East. On a general survey, we perceive that, in the nature of things, a polity of yesterday, surrounded on the one side by complex civilizations reaching back through millennia, and on the other by groups of barbarian tribesmen, could not permeate the whole world with light by a continuous process. The sudden emergence of light was, in fact, owing to a conjuncture of favorable circumstances, as well as to the natural genius of a race. The statesmen of later antiquity, when the reversal had begun, perfectly understood that, on the whole, their business was to check a decline. The first Eastern institution to return was absolute monarchy. The second was theocracy. The two were fatally connected, though it was still a question whether the latter should be nominal or should be an active power in the state. the mightiest Julius, the descendant of gods and kings, displayed his usual clear insight when he staked his whole future on being made Pontifex Maximus. United in one person or separated, the kingly and priestly dignities were henceforth necessary to each other. The framework of the republican type remained, indeed, after the victory of the monarchical cause, and it is easy to undervalue its preservation. In reality, it gave the Roman Empire what still distinguished it from the monarchies of the East. Caesarism, in the proper sense of the term, which may be described as a system resting on military loyalty to a quasi-royal family, lasted only from the Battle of Actium to the death of Nero. With Vespasian came a prelude to the recovery of influence by that party in the Senate which, sustained by the Stoic philosophy, had resisted pure absolutism. The reform was retarded for an interval by the tyranny of Domitian, more frightful in its sheer oppressiveness than anything that had gone before. But tyrannicide laid the foundation of nearly a century's good government. The emperors of the second century took in hand the task of organizing the imperial system so as to make the monarchy, as Tacitus put it, compatible with liberty. By Marcus Aurelius, Caesarism was expressly repudiated, and his ideal of the monarchy, republican in spirit, was still official in the third century. The Roman Empire, according to the view put forward, was not to be confounded with an Asiatic despotism. The emperor did not rule by arbitrary will, but according to law and for the common good. It was admitted that the rule of a single person had only become necessary through want of sufficient virtue in the multitude. If the republic had been possible, it would have been better that it should be retained. The old basis of civic religion also, it was held, must, as far as possible, be preserved. Suppression of barbarian cults, or their assimilation to the civic type, was to be undertaken by the state in accordance with the ideas of philosophical reformers. Human sacrifices were legally abolished, as they have been by the British government in India. Apart from abuses which it was hoped might gradually be got the better of, each city or country was to continue the practice of its own religion. This, indeed, had been the position of the early Caesars themselves. Augustus promoted religious reaction on a Roman basis, but, like his successors for nearly two centuries after his death, he maintained the old hostility to, quote, foreign superstitions, close quote. Those who directed practical affairs knew all along the terrible power latent in popular religion and the susceptibility of the multitude to waves of fanaticism. Civic religion, with its administration by state functionaries and its aesthetic forms used as a means of beautifying life, was obviously an artificial structure. The true natural religion, as Cardinal Newman perceived and said, is of the barbarian type, and, as he proceeded to show, it is this that contains the root ideas of the Christian religion. From foreign cults at Rome, there were occasions when nothing less was feared than the subversion of the state. The popular appeal in support of the native religion against more exciting mysteries could only be to patriotism. When this atrophied through loss of liberty, the whole battle was lost. At Athens, it is no accident that Demosthenes should try to associate his Macedonizing rival with the invocation of Huis Attis, Attis Huis. The overlordship of King Philip and the introduction of a strange god from Asia were instinctively seen to be parts of the same process. The process was complete when the mob of Antioch acclaimed the Chi and the Kappa against a sovereign who would not allow himself to be called despot. On the other side of the account, it must be remembered that the monarchy of Philip and Alexander was the means of introducing Hellenic culture into the Oriental world, and that culture penetrated by its pervasive force beyond the dominions of Alexander's successors. The kings of Parthia, for example, called themselves officially Philhellena. Asia, however, soon grew weary of this. The aggression of the West, ending in the conquests of the Roman Republic, at length stirred up the deep underlying desire to return to its own type. The populations, as has often been observed, were glad to be relieved from the contests of unfamiliar political factions, and to know only Caesar. But rumors such as that which is mentioned by Tacitus as current during the siege of Jerusalem reveal a profounder sentiment. The Jews, however, were too isolated in the East itself to fulfill the oracle literally, and to go forth and conquer in the name of resurgent darkness. Besides, the nobler elements in their character did not permit them to evolve the required ethics of submission. Jerusalem was not the cradle of the Catholic Church. The name of Christian was said to have been first heard at Antioch. With this, it is in accordance that one legend makes Peter bishop there before he became bishop of Rome. Now Antioch, while extremely cosmopolitan, was at the same time, as we know from Philostratus, the special aversion of the men of Hellenic culture. It was as typically un-Hellenic as it was Hellenistic. Around Antioch as a center, the literature of the new religion may have begun early in the second century. Up to then, we may suppose the mythology to have been elaborated by way of oral transmission and modification. About the time of the first writings, the sect had attracted the attention of the Roman authorities. Soon it began to appeal unto Caesar, as the heroes of its legend were to be represented as having done in the past. Keeping out of sight its sacramental and sacrificial base and its hierocratic superstructure, it tried to gain the sympathy of influential men by putting in the forefront its monotheism and the purity of its morals. It claimed to be especially useful in promoting obedience to the magistrates. But always, as Renan has pointed out, its hope was in the emperors personally. The fable that, on a report by Pontius Pilate relating the recent supernatural events in Judea, Tiberius moved in the Senate that Christ should be received into the Pantheon and that the assembled senators rejected the motion, had an obvious tendency. The emperor was the natural friend of the Christians. The Senate was their natural enemy. And indeed, it formed the last rallying ground of the opposition in Italy, as the Athenian schools of philosophy did in Greece. The empire of the second century, however, was not prepared to meet these overtures. There is a story that Hadrian once proposed to introduce the worship of Christ, but was dissuaded by an oracle, which pronounced that, if he carried out his design, all the other worships would cease. This, of course, is legendary, but it represents the real conjuncture of things. The official recognition of Christianity by the state meant that the rulers were to second the propaganda of an intolerant theocracy. If, among the Eastern worships, Mithraism was more favorably received, that was because it could be assimilated to the other cults of the empire, but it did not threaten to usurp the domain of philosophy. For absolutism, no pagan idea of apotheosis could be of greater service than the Christian doctrine of divine right, put forward in the epistolary and apologetic literature. Indeed, in the Middle Ages, not only the Pope, but the Emperor was called Deus in Terris. The opposition to Christianity, in distinction from the permitted cults, sprang from no self-interest on the part of the emperors who opposed it, but from their Roman patriotism and their training in the free Greek schools. How remote they were from the conception of philosophy itself as a state dogma is shown, for example, by the circumstance that Marcus Aurelius, while himself a Stoic, endowed chairs for all the schools of philosophy equally. In what precise manner Christianity was repressed before the accession of Commodus, when the repression was relaxed simultaneously with the acceleration of the drift to absolutism, we do not know, since nearly all the information comes to us in a legendary form. What we do know is that it was in motive political, it was not religious persecution. That the Christians underwent no serious persecution till the time of Diocletian has been proved once for all by Gibbon. This persecution was to be the prelude to their triumph under Constantine, who developed further the Oriental court etiquette and the formal absolutist administration that had marked the reign of his predecessor. In the meantime, the same anti-Hellenism was manifesting itself by a continued return wave in the remoter Eastern world. At the beginning of the 3rd century, the new Persian kingdom had been founded. The kingdom of the Sassanids was a church state, strictly intolerant in principle, successfully persecuting Christianity as well as heresies of native growth. Its substitution for the half-Hellenized kingdom of the Arsacides was only one more evidence of the drift of things. In the same period, the Roman Empire was becoming ever more accessible to Eastern cults, though the position of Christianity was still precarious. What the resistance of the second century had secured was a breathing space for a last effort of independent thought before the new hierarchy entered into possession. But this belongs to a later section. We must now return to the development of Christianity from the end of the first century onward. End of introduction, chapters 6 through 7. Introduction, chapters 8 through 12 of The Origins of Christianity by Thomas Whittaker. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Introduction, The Origins of Christianity. Chapter 8, Paulinism. The earliest literary expression of Christianity, though not the earliest type of doctrine, was Paulinism. Those who began to put forward a speculative Christianity in the name of Paul were the first Christians to write, precisely because they were the innovators. The epistles which form our collection grew out of a Pauline literature consisting of short doctrinal expositions and exhortations. They do not differ essentially from the other old Christian epistles, which were never actual letters, but from the first, edifying compositions ascribed to men of reputation in the past, bearing unmistakable marks of the present to which they belong. This view, which is von Manen's, set forth partly in his own words, I accept, but some readjustment is necessary in relation to the different position I have been obliged to take up with regard to the very earliest Christianity. The modification needed, however, is surprisingly little. The first question to arise is, who was this Paul? to whom doctrinal developments and then epistolary expositions of them were ascribed. According to von Manen, he was one of those who had been converted by the disciples of an actual Jesus to the belief that he was the Messiah. The new apostle, to adopt the later term, was especially active in missionary journeys, and hence was remembered with greater vividness than the rest. Some of those members of the Christian communities who, about the end of the first century or the beginning of the second, were departing from narrowly Judaic ideas, put themselves under the protection of his name, perhaps because the wide range of his activity suggested a larger tolerance of non-Jewish customs. Embellished accounts of his travels were written, on the basis partly of a diary of a fellow traveler. Of this diary we possess portions in the journey narrative of the canonical Acts of the Apostles. The narrative we possess has been somewhat manipulated, but the retention of the first person plural indicates a real diary. The genuine substratum that may be inferred is not inconsistent with the chronological position assigned to Paul in the legend. Thus, there was a point of contact for the Pauline literature in the actual life of one who lived in the generation preceding the destruction of Jerusalem. The modification I suggest is this. The Paul who was remembered was not, indeed, an associate of the disciples of an actual Jesus, but he belonged to a group of messianic propagandists of Judaism. Some such groups must have been vaguely remembered, and the Christians, in our sense, who arose after the destruction of Jerusalem, would naturally make use of their names, transforming them into disciples of the personal Jesus in whom they believed. The apostolic age was thus legendary, but not wholly mythical. No doubt there are considerable elements of pure myth, especially in the case of Peter, the rock apostle. And indeed, of the figures that remain, none has the least tangibility except Paul. Still, in the Paul of Acts and of the epistolary literature, there is left one figure which has the degree of reality to be sought in historical romance. This is the character of his trial before Festus. Like the trial of Apollonius of Tyana before Domitian, it may not represent anything that actually took place, but was composed in relation to a real personage, and it has some circumstances of a possible trial. It is not simply a transcription from a mystery play. The Paul who really lived may have traveled as far as Greece and Italy, and may have been finally lost sight of in Rome. Beyond the fragmentary narrative of a single journey preserved in Acts, there is, however, no hope of reconstructing his story. Even this view, which, so far as Paul is concerned, does not differ substantially from von Manen's, is not absolutely necessary to explain the Pauline literature. Considering similar attributions before and after, we might be inclined to say that a purely fictitious personality would suffice. Yet, the collection of circumstantial narratives in the Acts of the Apostles seems to point to some such view on the whole. These narratives are indeed full of miracles, but they seem better explained on the supposition that they are legends growing out of the propagandist activity of messianic Jews before the destruction of Jerusalem, than by dismissing them all as merely typical miracle stories about symbolical personages. For a fuller account of the doctrinal development called Paulinism, I refer to the exposition which follows. The conspicuous features of the Pauline Gospel are, of course, the insistence on faith that in Jesus the Christ has come, and on the grace that is given men to believe. This grace and this faith are the conditions of personal salvation. The Christ of Paul, the Son of God, in whom faith is required, and from whom grace comes, is the expression of a more exalted supernaturalism than that of the old messianists. The development is speculative rather than mythical or apocalyptic. The Johannine school, carrying this forward, gave satisfaction also to the concrete imagination, which felt the need to combine with it the belief in the reality of a Christ according to the flesh. For Paul, a merely apparent fleshly manifestation of the Christ would have been sufficient. There are indications in the epistles of what is afterwards called docetism. The school of John, by avoiding this development, conciliated the Orthodox. That is to say, those among the leaders who instinctively perceived the importance for governing mankind of keeping terms with the prepossessions of the crowd, which evidently could not let go the pathetic concrete Jesus, the equivalent for the Tammuz or Adonis of the old Semitic cult, the popular religious mythology, as distinguished from the philosophical mythology of the Christian Gnostics, to which by itself Paulinism tended, was thus saved. At the same time, John brought more exactitude than Paul into the philosophical side of the mythology. The Alexandrian idea of the mediating logos, or creative reason, between the supreme God of philosophy and of Judaism, and the world of man, was applied in a peculiar sense to Jesus Christ. The man of flesh and blood and the divine being were to be conceived as mystically united, and the Logos was not merely a power or aspect of God, but was God. Thus, the problem afterwards brought to an orthodox solution in the Nicene formula was posited. In any admissible solution, formal monotheism had to be retained. The average Christian consciousness was too Judaic to allow of a real second God. On the other hand, Christian theology, as it was brought more in contact with the schools, necessarily worked under the dominance of the triadic idea, which then fascinated speculative minds. Another mediating power, therefore, was required to complete the divine triad. This was found in the Holy Spirit, the Pneuma, a conception which also appeared in the line of Alexandrian Judaism. There is no need to go further into the complex process through which formal logic on the one side and the spirit of practical accommodation on the other worked to produce out of the scattered data of the New Testament the dogma of three co-equal persons or hypostases in one God. It may suffice to say that the type of solution is to be found implicitly in John. Paul admitted of more varied speculative development. What, then, was to become of the forward-striving movement of the Pauline school, which preceded the Johannine school, and was not absorbed into it? The answer is given in ecclesiastical history. The Catholic Church succeeded in nominally appropriating Paul, but he never ceased to be, what he had been called in the second century, the Apostle of the Heretics. A slight sketch of the new development by which the transition was made to a de-Catholicized Christianity will be necessary before concluding this introduction. In the meantime, it may be worthwhile to bring into view one or two indications that our collection of the epistles of Paul, like the New Testament generally, is long subsequent to the year 70. Such indications, indeed, have been made clear by von Manen in the epistles he specially deals with. And if these were abandoned, there could be no serious thought of defending the rest, while the abandonment of the rest would not by itself affect them. It is, therefore, merely for the sake of preliminary illustration, and not with the notion that the passages cited close the question, that I choose an instance from the Epistle to the Galatians and one from the Epistle to the Thessalonians. Take the allegory of the two covenants in Galatians chapter 4, verses 24 through 26. Does not the antithesis on the face of it apply to two religions, both of them conscious of its claims as such, the new not regarding itself as a mere sect of the old? But the verse to which I would draw special attention is chapter 4, verse 25, where it is said, in reference to the present Jerusalem, "For she is in bondage with her children." By contrast, "The Jerusalem which is above is free, which is the mother of us all." What would have been the point of this while Jerusalem, with its temple and its hierarchy, stood, not only secure, but full of hope, soon to be made the visible center of the kingdom of God on earth? A passage that tells, if possible, more strongly in the same sense, is 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 14 through 16. The Jews, of whom the apostle is supposed to be one, are contrary to all men, and the wrath is come upon them to the uttermost. The only question about the latter expression is whether it should not be referred to sometime shortly after 135, when the revolt that had finally broken out in the reign of Hadrian was suppressed. The former might have been borrowed from Tacitus. The point of view belongs to a Christianity of which the ambition to be a world religion was rising so high that it was already beginning to stir up anti-Semitism among the heathen. 9. The Catholic Church. According to the view taken in von Manen's work, the Pauline epistles in our present text are slightly Catholicized. It would be possible to treat the passage just quoted from 1 Thessalonians as an interpolation in this sense. The argument, however, would not have to be on purely textual grounds, but on grounds of the higher criticism. And, as von Manen has shown, when such a process is carried out thoroughly, the results are hardly more conservative than those that he has arrived at himself. In any case, the Pauline epistles did not originally express the ideas of that which afterwards became the Catholic Church. Paul, the ideal author of the series, was not, as Comte took him to be, the founder of Catholicism. Neither was he precisely, as Renan called him, the Protestant doctor. He may be best described as the father of Gnosticism. The earliest historic persons influenced by him were Basilides and Marcion. They developed the apostle, the only one they recognized, in the direction of their own anti-Judaism. This anti-Judaism was of a speculative kind. It does not seem to have been a form of embittered propaganda. The object of the Gnostics was not to capture the multitude and the state, but to maintain for themselves the position of higher speculative thinkers among the rising Christian communities. They had no decisive part in the ramifying organization by which Christian ecclesiastics succeeded in dominating the world. Indeed, they were themselves among those afterwards persecuted by its chiefs. The self-styled Catholic Church first became visible as a growing association of Christian communities animated by the ambition of succeeding to the theocratic powers of the Jewish hierarchy. These powers, as in the dreams of ancient seers, were to be expanded till they should sway the world. The special representatives of the dream of world dominion came now to be certain practical-minded office-bearers, ready to work by all methods, but, on the intellectual side, proceeding especially by compromise within limits. As time went on, they naturally became more and more hostile to those who, obstinately adhering to the elder Jewish community, seemed a living protest against their assumptions. An illustration of their characteristic mode of dealing with the protest was furnished, when they had come into power, by Cyril of Alexandria. It was not that they in the least sympathized, like the speculative Gnostics, with rebellion against the wrathful Jehovah of the Old Testament. On the contrary, they adopted into their canon the aspirations of the fiercest apocalyptists. Every soul that will not hear the new prophet shall be destroyed. Acts chapter 3, verse 23. The man-child, the seed of the woman, is to shepherd all the nations with a rod of iron. Revelation chapter 12, verse 5. His vesture is dipped in blood, and his name is the Word of God. Chapter 19, verse 13. In recompense for the persecutions and tribulations that they endure, the faithful shall rest with the apostles, when the Lord Jesus shall be revealed from heaven with the angels of his power, in flaming fire, taking vengeance on them that know not God, and that obey not the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verses 7 and 8. The ideal of the new theocracy was authoritative dogma socially supreme. Pure monotheism, combined with the practice of a ritual, would no longer suffice. The dogma had been complicated by the revival of archaic sacramental conceptions and by a new mythology, in part of pagan derivation. The horribilia secreta of killing the god and eating the god were to be brought within the forms of logic as if they were philosophical truths. The old idea of the national church state, the chosen people, had passed into that of universal hierarchy. In the notion, now definitely formulated, of heresy and schisms as crimes, was involved the deadly germ whence grew the historic system, compared with which the religions of Dahomey and of ancient Mexico were natural and amiable errors. Hopes of emancipation from the yoke of tyrannic custom that arose in the Christian communities, as they had arisen before in Greece, were systematically quenched. Definite and repeated sanction of slavery, thoroughgoing subjection of women, political maxims that have been rightly interpreted in the sense of passive obedience, may contrast with the spirit of much in the New Testament. But it is in them that we perceive the authentic mind of the church. And yet there could never be any doubt that, if they once came into conflict with the system of the hierarchy and its dogma, all civil and domestic ties would be dissolved. Criticism seems to have justified the audacious suggestion of Hobbes that what was originally meant by the sin against the Holy Ghost, which could never be forgiven, was resistance to the ecclesiastical power. This was the system that conquered in the 4th century. In its absence, no doubt the imperial government would, all the same, have become nominally theocratic. The deified emperor would have presided over a syncretism of recognized religions. Philosophy, withdrawn wholly from politics, or, if it ever touched them, recurring to the republican traditions of the past for illustrations, would have retained, in pure thought, the independence it possessed. the effective government would have been a secular despotism tempered by law, without the superposition of a spiritual tyranny in action. It is an interesting problem whether this would have been more easily broken through than the double order, secular and spiritual, handed down to the West. In any event, it could not have been more impregnably fixed than the Christian theocratic state of the East, which in its older form perished by foreign conquest, but which has never, so far, been shattered from within. And in comparison with Eastern Orthodoxy, it would have been a free and humane civilization. A more soluble question than this fascinating one of hypothetical history is the causation of events as they actually occurred. With the two systems of philosophic pagan comprehension and of Christian intolerance face to face, there could be no doubt, in the circumstances of the time, as to the issue. Even in a time of widely diffused science and freedom, the terrors and the glamour of superstition are not easily dispelled. When the conflict actually came, the world had already broken into autocracy, and the knowledge that there was of nature and history, though more than sufficient for dealing with the new dogmatists in equal debate, had no hold on the multitude. The theocracy, as its apologists boasted, had sapped the organization of the empire, and even if its devotees numbered less than a tenth of the indifferent or hostile, the transcendent threats and promises of its creed and its readiness, whenever its time came, to inflict sustained, not fitful persecution, would assure its victory. What it needed was that, in the contention for imperial power, a successful candidate should have seen the value of its support. Nominal tolerance accorded, the victory was won. The dominant faction in the church pressed ever more relentlessly through its court prelates for the persecution of its antagonists, whether mere polytheists or Christian heretics or philosophical Hellenists. Against popular superstitions not incorporated in its new pantheon of saints and martyrs, the religion of baptismal regeneration and of exorcism by the cross adopted the old laws against magic. Heresy, that is, choice of one's own belief, was made treason against God, as to which evidence could be elicited by torture, whether the accused was bond or free. Here there was equality. Lastly, the schools of philosophy were closed, their endowments confiscated, and those who should Hellenize proscribed. 10. The later history of Paulinism. With all their arrogant claims, and with all their weapons of fraud and violence, the great churches called Catholic and Orthodox have never for a moment succeeded in bringing within their unity even the whole of those who call themselves Christians. Heresies and schisms there have always been, and in spite of persecutions, their life has been again and again renewed. In this succession, the apostle of the heretics had an important part. After the Gnostics of the earliest Christian centuries, who were the first to attach themselves to the name of Paul, there came the Manichaeans, in whose doctrines there were Christian elements of the same derivation. Then, after the victory of the church, there survived in corners of the Eastern Empire the Paulicians, whose teaching at length, by a complex process, affected the West in the 11th and 12th centuries. The episode in which their heresy was stamped out is by general consent the most atrocious in the annals even of Christendom. There went on, nevertheless, groups hostile to the great church, but with a difference. the tendency now began to be in the direction of modern Protestantism. But, as before, so now, a basis was sought in the writings attributed to the Apostle Paul. Here takes place a curious transition, which has scarcely been enough dwelt on, though Gibbon clearly perceived it. For the anti-Judaic Paul of the Gnostics is substituted the essentially Judaizing Paul of the Protestant churches. That there are Judaizing passages in the epistles must, of course, be admitted. But it seems likely that the almost contemporary Gnostics had a truer feeling for the general drift of their ideal apostle than latecomers like the 14th century precursors of Luther and Calvin. Modern Protestants have interpreted their Paul in the light of the Old Testament canon accepted by the rabbis, and with the help of a judicial theory of the sacrifice of Christ, elaborated by Catholic doctors like Anselm. The Paulicians of the 12th century were still of the old Gnostic type, professing a dualism for which the God of the Jews was a subordinate, if not an evil being. In the 14th century, a new type of Paulinist, who yields to no Hebrew psalmist or prophet in devotion to Jehovah, has begun to emerge. In the 16th and 17th centuries, the type definitely appears. Less interesting from the speculative point of view, the new doctrine has proved of tougher fiber practically. With the Paulicianism of the Middle Ages, it had, however, one feature in common. Against the tyranny of priests and despots, it showed, as its strength grew, something of the spirit of insurgent theocracy, to the pulling down of strongholds. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 4. Moreover, since it denied the supernatural powers of the old hierarchy, it expelled, in practice, the forgiveness of sins. One who had faith might indeed believe that his sins were forgiven through Christ. But, after all, he was thrown back for satisfaction on his own conscience, which, as Kant says, is more exacting than a confessor. No one else could tell him that he was absolved. The commission to the apostles and their successors to remit sins or retain them was in effect cancelled. This was an immense gain for the moral progress, though the new doctrine of faith alone might in itself be no sounder than the old one of religious works, that is, devotional exercises. The insurgent side of the doctrine was just as beneficent. The divine right of kings was indeed preached even more zealously and in a more unqualified manner by Protestants than by Catholic ecclesiastics, when the papal overlordship had disappeared and there were Protestant state churches. But the genius of the new form of Christianity told against it. The destruction of political absolutism was begun by the Protestant nations. In this prelude of revolution, it is fair to allow that the reading of the Old Testament was not without effect. The Hebrew scriptures contain, indeed, the idea of legitimist theocracy, but they also contain, more effectively than anything in Paul, the ideas of theocrats in revolt, who will obey none but an invisible king, and who are even on the way to refuse submission to priests as his interpreters. Not that such ideas have the least positive value for the founding of a constitution. The development of the English polity, for example, would have been impossible without the structural basis of old Teutonic or other customary rights, reinforced by intellectual conceptions of the state, derived not from Judea, but from Greece and Rome. Still, without the element of Hebraic fervor, all might have ended in antiquarianism and literary reminiscences. The sacredness of Christian monarchy, as it still appeared to the devout and loyal imagination of the 17th century, had to be counteracted by the popular force of a religious emotion on the other side. We have thus, at a few strides, got far away from the origins and arrived at the time of the irrevocable disruption of Christendom on a worldwide scale. From this time forth, it has also been confronted as a whole with independent or free thought. If we recross the intermediate period, then, as we approach the origins, we find the position in this respect on the surface identical. Revealed religion has not yet come into full possession of the power, which it was to retain for over 1,000 years, but at length to lose, of repressing the liberty of philosophizing. Before concluding, we must dwell for a moment on this last phase of the ancient world. 11. Philosophy against revealed religion. The remark was made above that the resistance of the second century to the propagandists of the new revelations secured a breathing space for independent philosophy. This respite enabled Plotinus in the third century to found the last great philosophical system of antiquity, since known as Neoplatonism, without so much as naming the Catholic Church, though in one book he opposed the doctrines of the Gnostics. The Gnostic Christians, with their high speculative pretensions, no doubt seemed better worth refutation at the hands of a philosopher than the Orthodox, who would, to him, represent only the purely deceptive side of the movement. Plotinus finds, indeed, in the Gnostics, a sort of blurred reflection on Plato. And yet we should know from his tractate, if we had no other evidence, that they too were anti-Hellenic fanatics, full of the arrogance which regarded the whole visible world and all men except the Christians as shut out from the care of divine, as distinguished from demonic or even diabolic power. The new philosophical development was not, in the long run, without benefit to Christianity itself, as a system which could give satisfaction to those who sought, in religion, higher elements than creed and ceremonial. Much that ordinarily passes for Christianity is really Stoicism or Platonism, and the Neoplatonists, becoming the authorized expositors of the ancient philosophy, so long as the teaching of it was unsuppressed, imbued educated Christians with some of the learning of the schools. Besides, they made contributions of their own to speculation, which Christian thinkers found their advantage in borrowing. In view of all that has been said about the theurgy of the school, it is necessary to point out that Neoplatonism remained essentially a philosophy. It had no new religion to advocate, but, if allowed, would have continued the process of allegorizing and morally reforming the religions of the Greco-Roman world. Some members of the school refused to have anything to do with theurgy, and, if others were infected with the contagion of the age, that is not surprising. What divides them all fundamentally from the Christians, and indeed from the Oriental world generally, is their attitude to mythology. With them, myth is clearly distinguished from science. They allegorize the adventures of a god, while denying explicitly that what is related of the god ever took place. It appears that some, following Plato himself, objected even to this degree of compliance with popular religion. Proclus, in his commentary on the Republic, argues against those who blamed the Greek myths for giving a handle to the Christians, who were accustomed to make points by denouncing their immorality. His reply is singularly modern. The abuse does not take away the use. It might equally well be urged that intoxicants ought to be expelled from the state because some indulge in them to excess. Divine myths are to be used in moderation. They are to be treated in their obvious sense as myths, and not as an expression of pure reason. But a philosophical meaning is to be sought under them. Now, of course, the mode of allegorizing Homer, common to the latter Greek schools, while often interesting in itself, led away from the truth about the real nature of the poems, which were not expositions of philosophical theology. But it is well to recognize that after all there is something in the point of view. The old myth-makers, not being able to express themselves by abstractions, but only by imagery, did often convey a general truth by this means. The philosophers themselves, in putting forth their interpretations, were accustomed to express a doubt whether this had been done self-consciously or by a sort of instinct. It is still quite easy to find, under stories like The Fall of Man or The Tower of Babel, such mythical truth as was found under many Greek myths. And a philosopher cannot reasonably be blamed for exercising his ingenuity in this way. Dum vera re tamen ipse, religione animum turbi contigere parcat. The meaning educed from the Bible stories, as from similar stories in Hesiod, may have been put there originally. They seem to be examples of myth passing into the reflective stage. At any rate, the question would furnish an interesting topic for disputation. And it must be conceded that, if the philosophers could have retained for popular use the old system as against the new, they would have preserving for the time a less cruel superstition. The Christians, much as some might have liked to be rid of the whole tradition that had preceded them, soon found that, to keep their hold on a world still inheriting the remains of intellectual culture, they needed a formal philosophy to combine with their mythology. This they could only derive from the Greek schools. Neoplatonism furnished them with their later theory of the immaterial soul. And it is a remarkable fact that a religion, said to have been revealed, has had to recur, for every serious effort to find in the universe the manifestation of a rational and moral order, to thinkers who never pretended to have obtained what they might offer in this direction by anything but the exercise of their own reason. Some tribute ought to be paid to the better minds in the period of established Christianity for thus going back to the wisdom of the Greeks, so contemptuously contrasted in documents they held sacred with the foolishness that was to confound it. We owe, for example, to William of Morbeka, the Dominican Archbishop of Corinth in the latter part of the 13th century, the preservation, in a Latin version, of three treatises of Proclus, containing the exposition of his theodicy. And these, in the half-unintelligible translation, may still be read with interest. While Leibniz's corresponding treatise, through its official acceptance of elements common to the Protestant and Catholic creeds of the 17th century, is already obsolete. The radical question between the Neoplatonists and the Christians was whether philosophy should be formally above popular religion or popular religion above philosophy. A system of thought summing up for its time the tradition of the highest civilization attained could not submit to become the handmaid of a faith it regarded as barbarian. and this was to be the position assigned to philosophy during the lowered civilization into which Europe was now sinking. In modern times, philosophy has again so far emancipated itself that it can subsist as a kind of scientific specialism without doing homage to the creed still nominally accepted by the world at large. But till the position is formally reversed, the ancient civilization, in which all who were not content simply with custom sought light from philosophy, must be classed as, in this respect, higher than the modern. Of course, no one would propose to revive Neoplatonism as a philosophic creed. It has, however, some typical value as the result of a long process of thought, which, cautious as it might have to be in relation to popular feeling, needed to pay deference to no constituted authority in matters of opinion. How long has this been true of modern philosophy? 12. Conclusion. A short writing entitled Derision of the Gentile Philosophers, by a certain Hermias, otherwise unknown, throws interesting light on the attitude of the victorious faith about the 5th or 6th century. The author begins, quote, "Paul, the blessed apostle, writing to the Corinthians, declared, 'O beloved, the wisdom of this world is folly with God,' speaking not at random, for I think it took its origin from the apostasy of the angels, through which cause the philosophers set forth opinions neither in harmony nor correspondent." Close quote. Simplicius, one of the Neoplatonists who sought philosophic liberty in Persia when the schools at Athens were closed by Justinian, puts the other side of the case. "We must not think," he says, "that the differences of expression among philosophers indicate such absolute opposition as they are reproached with by some, who, acquainted only with historical compendia, understand nothing of what they read. Moreover, those who reproach them are themselves cloven by schisms innumerable, not about physical principles, for of these no notion visits them even in dream, but about the mode of degrading the divinity. As a matter of fact, the method of Hermias is precisely that which is here hinted at. Such and such a philosopher," says the derider, "held that water was the principle of things, another the infinite, another air, another fire, and so forth. Which am I to believe?" On the emergence of truth from free discussion, he has no conception. Since the philosophers do not offer him an infallible revelation, their wisdom is folly. The most interesting passage comes at the end, where he successively scoffs at the Pythagoreans and the Epicureans. "Pythagoras," the inquirer is supposed to cry out, "measures the world. And I, raised to enthusiasm by this idea, forget family and country and wife and children, and set out on an expedition to measure all the elements. If, mighty body and mighty soul that I am, I do not go up to heaven and measure the ether, the dominion of Zeus is gone. When Zeus has learned from me how many angles fire has, I again descend. And, eating olives and figs and herbs, I apply my measuring rod to the moist substance, and teach Poseidon what is the extent of the sea he rules. I know also the number of the stars, and of fishes, and of beasts. And, by placing the world in balance, I can easily learn its weight. But," he proceeds, "I am not yet at the end of my labors. Epicurus comes and tells me that I have measured one world, indeed, but that there are many and infinite worlds. I furnish myself with provisions for a few days, and set out to measure these also. At length, having measured, say, the thousandth world, I become bewildered. Quote, but why do I delay to number the very atoms, out of which so many worlds have come into being? To the end that I may leave nothing unexplored, especially of things that are so necessary and useful to the prosperity of a household and a city. Close quote. By a strange irony of events, the derider of philosophy, in what he says of measurement and number and atoms, has sketched out the program which became that of modern science when the great darkness had receded. If we are to guard against the return of that darkness, we must remain faithful to the principle that was the final object of his scorn, the disinterested pursuit of truth. End of introduction, chapters 8 through 12. Part 1, Section 1 of The Origins of Christianity by Thomas Whittaker. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Von Manen on the Pauline Literature. Part 1, The Acts of the Apostles. Section 1, The Origin of Acts. Introduction. In our investigation of the Pauline epistles and the history of Paulinism, it is desirable, first, to arrive at a judgment on the historical value of the Acts of the Apostles. Here, two opposite errors are to be avoided. The Tübingen school, assuming the genuineness of the epistles to the Romans, Corinthians 1 and 2, and Galatians, set aside the testimony of Acts wherever it conflicted with what was supposed to be a direct statement of Paul. By reaction from this arbitrary procedure, the danger has arisen that the trustworthiness of the representation of Paul's life and work in Acts may, with no less arbitrariness, be taken for granted, as against the representation in the epistles. In view of this, we must, for the moment, postpone the discussion of the epistles, and examine the Acts of the Apostles as a book standing by itself. If we can here arrive at security, we shall have gained a foothold not to be despised for our further inquiries. Section 1. The Origin of Acts. 1. The Unity of the Work. We have not before us the work of an eyewitness of the events narrated. These are too far apart in time and place for the unity to be of this kind. Yet there is no doubt about the unity itself. The book is no loose stringing together of reports or traditions from various sources, but has a definite order and plan. There are references in the latter to the earlier portions of the narrative, and when the connection has been broken, it is expressly taken up again. The history, too, has a definite movement. We see Christianity spreading into wider and wider circles, from Jews to Samaritans, to God-fearing heathens like Cornelius, and then to ordinary Greeks, till at last its universal destination is made visible. The apostles come to the consciousness of this by degrees. It is true that we may speak of a Petrine and of a Pauline part of the Acts, but these have numerous interconnections. Like the third gospel, this second book of Luke, as we may call the writer for convenience, is a rounded off whole. Note, there is no reason, as von Manen remarks, for rejecting the tradition which assigns the third gospel and the Acts of the Apostles to the same author. The author, however, was not Luke, the companion of Paul mentioned in the epistles. a conjecture is offered later to account for the attachment of his name to the two works. End note. The appearance of incompleteness, due to the abrupt conclusion, is only apparent. That Paul was to die at Rome had been already hinted. Chapter 20, verses 22 through 24, chapter 21, verse 4 and 11 through 14, chapter 27, verses 23 and 24. For not actually mentioning his death, as it took place there according to tradition, the reason most probably was that the writer did not wish to arouse prejudice on the part of the Romans, whom it was his object to prepossess in favor of Christianity. The persistency with which that aim is kept in view is another proof of the unity of the work. The Jews are represented as rejecting and persecuting the new way, the Romans as benevolently disposed towards it, and as taking its missionaries under their protection. No speaker for the cause of Christianity fails to make it clear that, although Pilate gave his assent to the death of Jesus, the guilt was with the Jews. Persecution of Christianity, the writer is bent on showing, had never, in those days, taken its origin from the Romans. How, then, it is implicitly argued, can another line of action now be taken against the people, everywhere spoken against, though they might be, whose great apostle had been constantly moving about in the heathen world, and had himself been a Roman citizen? Note, this, as we shall see later, was probably a fiction of Luke. The apology directed to the Roman points, of course, to the second century, which is indicated by various other circumstances as the period when the book assumed its present form. End note. No difference as regards the universal destination of the gospel is represented as existing between Peter and Paul. Peter speaks of himself as chosen from ancient days to preach the gospel among the heathen. Chapter 15, verse 7. None of the chiefs raise any objections to the un-Jewish proceedings of Paul and Barnabas. On the other side, Paul displays no hostility to the brethren at Jerusalem. As a rule, he does not address himself to the heathen till forced by the obstinacy of the Jews. He is, from the first, in vital and constant relations with the mother community, and submits to its decisions. And in every forward step that he takes, he has been preceded by someone else. To all, he consistently proclaims his belief in the law. Note, it is this representation in particular that is in such glaring contradiction with that of Galatians, and led directly, the epistles being supposed genuine, to the assumption of the general untrustworthiness of Acts. End note. The style, which remains the same with few exceptions, even in the speeches of different persons, is another proof of the unity of the book. This casting of all into a certain form, however, does not prove the whole to be a work of poetic reflection, or the persons a free creation. Neither is it simply contemporary history plus tradition. Luke also had written sources. 2. Its composition. The evidences, indeed, of imaginative reconstruction are plain. Peter could not, in addressing his fellow countrymen, have spoken of the Jewish authorities as your rulers, chapter 3, verse 17, nor of the sending of the Son of God first to Israel, chapter 3, verse 26. In the vehement outburst at the end of Stephen's speech, we hear the voice, not of Stephen himself over against the Sanhedrin, but of the later Christianity against the Judaism from which it had separated, and which had since had abundant opportunity to resist the Holy Ghost. It is a similar dramatic transference of the ideas of the present to the past, when Paul and Barnabas turn to the Gentiles, chapter 13, verse 46. Readers are to be made to feel that Paul is compelled to take this step because the Jews have rejected the grace of God. This is also the effect aimed at in the bitter and at the same time foolish outburst of Paul against the Jews at Corinth, chapter 18, verse 6. That the work is not a free composition all through is shown, however, by the intermingling of inconsistent traditions. In the account of the speaking with tongues, the older tradition, that it was an affection, such as is described in 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and 14, is fused with the newer, that it was a gift instantaneously conferred of speaking foreign languages. To the latter, the accusation of being drunk could have no relevance. Sometimes it is the imparting of the Holy Ghost, sometimes it is baptism, that is the mark of the Christian. In chapter 11, verse 16, the being baptized with the Holy Ghost of the Christians is set over against the baptizing with water of John. In the other tradition, to receive the Holy Ghost is a special gift independent of baptism. Again, in chapter 19, verse 5, converts at Ephesus are to be rebaptized after having been baptized with the baptism of John, that they may receive the Holy Ghost. With this is connected another double tradition. On the one side, the apostles are clearly indicated as the highest authority among Christians. They have a doctrine which is to be adhered to, chapter 2, verse 42. Work miracles, have the power of life and death, appoint deacons, remain as a high court at Jerusalem, send out missionaries. All submit to their dogmas, chapter 16, verse 4. Luke, however, knows a different tradition, according to which the highest authority among Christians is the Holy Ghost, by which the overseers of the flock are directly appointed, chapter 20, verse 28. Sometimes he attempts to combine these two traditions, as, for example, when the decision of the council at Jerusalem is put in the form, "It seemed good to the Holy Ghost and to us," chapter 15, verse 28. The eldest community is, on the one hand, represented as an ideal of love and harmony. On the other hand, there are such circumstances as the contention among the widows that led to the appointment of deacons, chapter 6, verses 1 through 7. The small-minded quarreling about eating with heathen converts, and so forth. The community spreads rapidly, and yet can remain long undisturbed at Jerusalem. It has favor with all the people, chapter 2, verse 47, and yet is subjected from the first to mockery and persecutions. Paul has scarcely gone over to Christianity when his life is threatened. Luke knows different answers to the question, "Who first made converts among the heathen?" One account would ascribe this to the evangelist Philip, another to Peter, a third to certain men of Cyprus and Cyrene, chapter 11, verses 19 through 22, a fourth to Paul and Barnabas, chapter 13, verses 46 through 49, a fifth to Paul and no one else. To this end was Paul chosen by the Lord from the first, chapter 9, verse 15, chapter 22, verse 21, chapter 26, verses 16 through 18. The presence of this tradition is especially evident in Luke's abrupt way of making him turn his back on the Jews to whom he has only just addressed himself. About Paul himself, the traditions are inconsistent. He is a young man, apparently of no special importance, at the time of the death of Stephen, and yet is old enough to become immediately afterwards the moving spirit of a bloody persecution, which ceases when he goes over to Christianity. Chapter 9, verse 31. He is represented as a contemporary of the apostles, and in constant relations with them. Yet, on his last visit to Jerusalem, he is received not by the apostles, but only by the brethren. Altogether, it is here as if we were in a later generation. Luke knows the tradition according to which his calling was not of men, but from the risen Lord. He knows also an account in which Ananias plays an important part in his conversion. In accordance with this representation, Paul seeks and gains access to the apostles, obeys their directions, and submits to their decisions. Luke has a double view as to the circle in which he was called to work. Sometimes he is represented as having the heathen pointed out to him from the first as the goal of his endeavors. Among his converts, Greeks are especially mentioned. Where the heathen converts come from, however, is not always clear. At Borea, for example, nothing can be inferred from the context but that they came from the synagogue of the Jews. Chapter 17, verse 12. At Athens, he both visits the synagogue and speaks publicly to all alike. To James and the presbyters at Jerusalem, chapter 21, verse 19, he has nothing to report on his activity among the Jews, but tells what God has done among the Gentiles by his ministry. According to another conception of that ministry, it always began with the Jews, and it had some success among them. They are put in the first place among those addressed at Athens. Chapter 17, verse 17. Though we hear nothing of them there afterwards. The Jews look upon him as having to do especially with them, since they are constantly accusing him and raising tumults against him. He is regarded by them as their special enemy. Chapter 21, verse 28. On the substance also of Paul's preaching, Luke knows a double tradition. According to one conception of it, not only the Athenians, but the Jews and even the first Christians would have had a right to speak of his new doctrine and to call him a setter forth of strange gods. Jesus is proclaimed no longer as the Christ, in the sense of the Messiah promised to Israel, but as Jesus Christ, the Son of God, newly revealed, and the object of a faith which justifies and saves, as the law cannot do. Through him is forgiveness of sins. The grace of God and eternal life are for the believers in Christ. Paul does not preach the God of the Jews, but a God hitherto unknown. Chapter 17, verse 23. This God dwells not in temples made with hands, hence not in the shrine at Jerusalem. Paul's Jewish and primitive Christian opponents alike know well that he does not really keep the law. Side by side with this, however, there is another representation, according to which he simply taught that Christ, the Jewish Messiah, must needs have suffered and risen again from the dead. Chapter 17, verse 3. The content of his preaching is not, as elsewhere, the new gospel of the grace of God, but the traditional kingdom of God. Chapter 19, verse 8, etc. Into which Christians must enter through much tribulation. Chapter 16, verse 22. He has done nothing against his people or its law, of which he has been from first to last a scrupulous observer. Chapter 28, verse 17, chapter 21, verses 20 through 27. Even as a Christian, he is a worshipper of the God of his fathers. Chapter 24, verse 14. Luke endeavors to reconcile these two views by their simple juxtaposition. This may be seen in the peculiar form of statement about Paul's preaching. For example, chapter 9, verse 20. To preach Jesus, and that this is the Son of God, may still be discerned as two conceptions, which have not arrived at complete fusion. As might be conjectured from his introduction to the third gospel, Luke has drawn for these various traditions partly on written sources. This can be proved by a direct examination of Acts. Various confusions and contradictions in the narrative are explicable by a partially free working up of material, together with retention to a certain extent of the very phrases of the documents. The words "through the Holy Ghost" in chapter 1 verse 2 have the appearance of an interpolation by someone who wished to say that Jesus taught by the Holy Spirit before his ascension, a statement really inconsistent with chapter 1 verses 4 and 5, according to which the disciples were to wait at Jerusalem for it to be given. If there is no reason to think that the interpolator was anyone but the author of the book, then we may suppose him to have extended a sentence which he took over from some previous narrator, and not to have noticed the effect of the addition. A similar explanation will apply to the confused passage, verses 12 through 15. So also to Gamaliel's warning in verses 38 through 39, which obviously breaks the connection. The representations and the interrupted connection in the account of the death of Stephen may be similarly explained by insertions from Luke's hand in a narrative on which he worked. The account of Simon Magus points to the use of two different sources, in one of which the effect produced by the preaching of Philip was celebrated, while in the other the Samaritan magician was represented as trying to get the Holy Ghost at his disposal, like the apostles. Passing over other instances of imperfect redaction, we come to the passages, of which chapter 16 verse 10 offers the first example, where the narrative changes from the third person to the first. This points to the literal taking over of fragments from an itinerary and will occupy us later. In the meantime, one or two cases may be noted that come further on in the book. The Areopagus, where Paul is said to have delivered his discourse at Athens, chapter 17 verse 19, was a law court. Here was no place where everyone was at liberty to expound his theology to passers-by. Perhaps Luke found it stated, in the source he used, that at Athens, as elsewhere, Paul had had to defend himself before the legal authorities. This would explain the circumstance that those who brought him to the Areopagus are said to have laid hold of him. The author, working over this in his own way, imagined an encounter with philosophers curious to hear a new doctrine set forth. In chapter 19 verse 14, seven sons of Sceva are spoken of. They are afterwards, chapter 19 verse 16, referred to as both. The probable explanation is that Luke curtailed the intermediate narrative, transcribing literally the portions of it which he took over. Lastly, observe what seems the hopeless confusion of chapter 20 verses 4 and 5, where those who followed are said to have gone before. There were then written sources. Can we ascertain what those sources were? 3. Sources. Pauline letters. Were our epistles of Paul among the sources? Of one thing there is no doubt. The author nowhere makes mention of a letter written by Paul. However this may be explained, it does not lead us to expect diligent use in his work of a collection of Pauline epistles. Exact investigation of the details entirely supports the presumption, if we do not take for granted that the epistles, being older, must have been used. Some points of detail seem to show that the writer knew Pauline letters, perhaps a collection, and borrowed one or two things from them. But such points are not numerous. For example, the resemblance between Acts chapter 15 and Galatians chapter 2 is so striking, in spite of much difference, that we are justified in supposing one of the accounts of the apostolic meeting to have been known to the writer of the other, unless we suppose dependence on a common source. If the last supposition is thought improbable, then it is the writer of Acts who must have had the corresponding passage of Galatians in his eye. For, had the dependence been the other way, the writer of Galatians could not have failed to appeal to the concessions made to the heathen converts, not only by Peter, but by James himself, who figures in Galatians as the most decided opponent of Paul. On the other hand, some of the details in Galatians would not at all have served the purpose of Luke with his endeavor towards reconciliation of the rival parties. Hence, he would be inclined to omit them. The itinerary. In the second, or Pauline, part of Acts, there are some pieces where the writer speaks in the first person plural, namely, chapter 16 verses 10 through 17, chapter 20 verses 5 through 15, chapter 21 verses 1 through 18, chapter 27 verse 1 through chapter 28 verse 16. These, although we shall find no reason against the view that they contain portions of a diary written by a fellow traveler of Paul, cannot, as they stand, have formed part of such a diary. For this, they are too much worked up into the historical form of the book, and show too many traces of modification in accordance with that form. Take the fourth of them, which includes the account of the shipwreck. Many circumstances indicate that in the earlier narrative, Paul made his voyage from Caesarea to Rome, not as a prisoner, but with his friends as a free man. Those who accompanied him to Jerusalem, chapter 21, verse 16, or at least a part of them, are still with him at Caesarea when he sets out for Italy, namely, the companions spoken of as we, together with Aristarchus of Thessalonica, already mentioned as a traveling companion. Chapter 27, verse 2. Compare chapter 20, verse 4. This suggests a short stay at Caesarea after the visit to Jerusalem, rather than a 2 years' imprisonment. Details are preserved as to Paul's treatment on board ship, which seem natural in the case of one who is making a voyage freely, but not in the case of a prisoner. The texture of the narrative shows discontinuities at the points when his bonds are spoken of. In chapter 27, verse 3, for example, the reference to the centurion breaks the connection. The account of what took place on the island of Melita bears marks, even in the grammar, as is to be observed in chapter 28, verse 2, of the fusion of an original narrative with more or less legendary anecdotes. When the fragments are disentangled, they present themselves as a plain statement of the experiences of a single journey. No fragments from the same source can be detected in any passages but the four constituting this we narrative, as it is called. The view of some critics that the author preserved the form because he wished to pass himself off as a traveling companion of Paul must be rejected on the ground that, if that had been his aim, we should expect the first person plural to be used in all the accounts of Paul's journey. Luke takes no pains to conceal from his readers that he is other than the we of the passages in question. The very fact that he is a skillful writer goes to show that, if he had intended to convey the misleading impression that he was an eyewitness all through, he would have taken other means. The we narrative does not supply us with a full account of Paul's activity. Its character is that of external note-taking, and even in its original form, it cannot have been a composition aiming at any sort of completeness. As far as it goes, however, there is no single reason for regarding it as other than the work of an eyewitness or as untrustworthy. Who the author was, we can only guess. That he was a Jew by birth may be inferred from his use of the Jewish calendar, chapter 20, verse 6, chapter 27, verse 9. Such data as there are point to the Luke of Pauline tradition. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 11, Philemon verse 24, Colossians chapter 4, verse 14. This assignment of authorship would have the advantage of explaining how the whole of Acts, together with the third gospel, came to be assigned to Luke. To return to our Luke, the author of Acts, whence did he get his other data about Paul, which he combined with the diary? It is necessary, as we shall soon find, to suppose that he drew on a narrative written before his own time, but after the time when the diary was written. Probably the diary was already incorporated with this narrative when he took it over. Otherwise, we should have to suppose that it had survived till then unused. From the narrative then extant, or from tradition, he got the datum about Paul's imprisonment. The original form of this story may be preserved in the assertion, first met with in Eusebius, Ecclesiastical History, Book 2, Section 22, that Paul was imprisoned a second time at Rome. In the earlier narrative, we may suppose, the apostle was arrested on some accusation relating to his activity in Rome itself, whither he had come as a freed man, and the imprisonment that followed was the only one mentioned. Next, the arrest was transferred to Jerusalem, as in the narrative of Acts, which represents him as conveyed in bonds from Caesarea to Rome. Then, finally, the account in Acts, having in the meantime become authoritative, the single imprisonment at Rome was described as a second imprisonment. Of course, it does not follow that the earlier tradition itself is historical. Acts of Paul. Notwithstanding all resemblances in style and treatment, a difference at once strikes the reader between the so-called Petrine and Pauline parts of the book. That is to say, in general and exceptions allowed for, between chapters 1 through 12 and chapters 13 through 28. The latter part is livelier, fresher. It gives the impression of being less legendary and more true. The writer seems to stand closer to the facts. The details confirm this impression and point to one principal source used by Luke for this part of his work. That source, in accordance with the known titles of books of the kind, we may call the Acts of Paul. The use of the Acts of Paul first becomes conspicuous in the description of Paul's so-called first missionary journey with Barnabas. In the original account, as is still evident, chapter 13, verses 2 and 4, they were sent on their mission directly by the Holy Ghost. The statement that they were sent by the community, chapter 13, verse 3, is in obvious contradiction with what goes before and after. Paul, as in most places still, and not Barnabas, as in verses 1, 2, and 7, was everywhere the chief person. He was called Paul from the first, and not at the beginning Saul, verses 1 through 9, and then abruptly and without reason assigned Paul, bar Jesus, chapter 13, verses 6 through 12, was originally neither a sorcerer nor a Jew, but a type of the pre-Pauline Christians, with their dread of the new doctrine preached by the men full of the Holy Ghost. From the Acts of Paul, Luke may have borrowed some expressions in the speech at the Pisidian Antioch, chapter 13, verses 16 through 41, as, for example, that through Christ forgiveness of sins is proclaimed, verse 38, that through him everyone that believes is justified, verse 39. This was the Pauline gospel of faith and grace. Compare chapter 13, verse 43. Some things from the Pauline document have been taken up into the earlier chapters of Acts. This is probably the case with the mention of Barnabas, chapter 4, verses 36 through 37, whose name originally belonged not to the community at Jerusalem, but to the circle of Paul at Antioch. Compare chapters 13 through 15. All the names of the seven appointed to serve tables, chapter 6, verses 1 through 6, are Greek and suggest that the deacons were non-Jews. It may be conjectured that in the earlier account they were neither appointed by the 12 nor at Jerusalem. To suppose a preponderantly heathen Christian community already there is inconsistent with the representation in other parts of Acts. Compare chapter 21, verse 20. Luke may have derived the account from the Acts of Paul, where it had reference to events outside Palestine, and transferred it to Jerusalem. The same conjecture applies to the martyrdom of Stephen, accused of attributing to Jesus the purpose of changing the Mosaic law, chapter 6, verse 14. The account of a violent effort to uproot Christianity, starting from Jerusalem, in which Saul Paul played a leading part, has been transferred, probably but not certainly, from Damascus. There are passages in which not only the apostles but the brethren also are described as remaining in quiet at Jerusalem, while the execution of James, the brother of John, is mentioned as an isolated event, chapter 12, verse 2. And the passage in Galatians, chapter 1, verses 13 through 22, where Paul describes himself as having persecuted the church of God, assumes that he was resident at Damascus at the time of his conversion, and not at Jerusalem. Whether Luke found the persecution by Paul and his conversion already side by side in the Acts of Paul, or brought them together, must remain uncertain. In the chapters containing the main body of the Acts of Paul, the following points are to be noted. The account of the gathering at Jerusalem, chapter 15, verses 1 through 33, as a whole and in the form in which we have it, cannot have come from that source. The Paul of Paulinism is to be seen, rather, in passages where the opposition between his direction and that of the Judaizers among the chiefs is more pronounced. The declaration of Paul that he is a Roman citizen comes from Luke, with his desire to place Christianity in a favorable light before the Romans. This tendency was foreign to the Acts of Paul. The representation also that Paul went first to the Jews belongs to Luke's redaction. The converts that he had read of in his source were especially Greeks, as at Berea, chapter 17, verse 12. Luke prepares the way for turning the pre-Pauline Christians of Ephesus, to whom the Paul of the earlier document made known the Holy Ghost, chapter 19, verses 1 through 7, into disciples of John the Baptist. To his hand is due the town clerk's apology for the Christians. He manipulates Paul's statement at Jerusalem, chapter 21, verse 39, that he is of Tarsus, no mean city, by making him insist at the same time that he is a Jew. This can be inferred from the peculiarity of the antithesis, the force of which is a Jew, though of Tarsus. Moreover, it is known from Epiphanius, Against Heresies, chapter 30, paragraph 16, that certain Ebionites, probably in their own version of the Acts of Paul, preserved the original reading, in which there is no mention of Paul's Jewish origin, and in which the reminder to the less instructed reader where Tarsus is, namely in Cilicia, does not occur. Luke's modification, effected by stages, in the events at Jerusalem, as recounted in the Acts of Paul, may be detected in the changing representation of his opponents, first as Judaizing Christians among the believers there, chapter 21, verse 20, then as Jews from Asia, chapter 21, verse 27, lastly as the Jews, in general, together with the Sanhedrin. In the earlier story, they would seem to have included anti-Pauline Christians. To escape the tumult raised by them, Paul was conducted to Caesarea by the faithful brethren, introduced too early by Luke, chapter 9, verse 29 through 30. Thence he went to Rome as a free man. How the Acts of Paul ended, we can only conjecture, but it seems likely that an account was given of his imprisonment at Rome and his death there as a martyr, hinted at by Luke, but omitted, in accordance with his apologetic aim in relation to the Roman government. An uncanonical book entitled Acts of Paul is referred to by Eusebius. Was this identical with the Acts of Paul mentioned by Origen? Or do both writers refer to the book used, perhaps in an earlier redaction, by Luke? It is not impossible, but we are not advanced by the supposition, since there is no material for judging of the contents of the book outside the canonical Acts of the Apostles. According to the best judgment we can form, it presents itself as too full of legendary stories to have been written by a contemporary of Paul. The really contemporary record of the "we" narrative, as has been said, was probably worked up into it by the unknown author. The date of the Acts of Paul may be placed, provisionally, not earlier than the end of the first century, before which time the outlines of the remodeled Christianity, known as Paulinism, cannot be conceived to have fixed themselves. This, however, is somewhat to anticipate the result of discussion of the epistles. The Pauline substratum in the Acts of the Apostles must be placed earlier than the earliest of these. For while the direction of thought that appears there has much in common with that of the epistles, no use is made of them, and an epistolary activity of Paul is in no way alluded to. Acts of Peter. The particular document which forms the basis of the first 12 chapters of our canonical Acts may be called, most conveniently, the Acts of Peter. It is a counterpart of the Acts of Paul, and was evidently written with the Paul of the older document as a model. For the hypothesis of independent origin, the parallelisms with the story of Paul are too numerous, and, this hypothesis being excluded, the exaggerations of the legendary and miraculous element in what is related of Peter show the narrative of which he is the hero to be secondary. Contrast, for example, the account of his deliverance from prison by an angel, chapter 12, verses 3 through 19, with the account of Paul's deliverance at Philippi, chapter 16, verses 19 through 40. The latter leaves open the interpretation that it is the form assumed in tradition by some historical event, whereas the first is evidently nothing but a miracle story. The possibility and even the probability that the writer made use here and there of traditions that had come to him from other sources is not excluded. But the way in which, always with the aim of glorifying Peter and his circle, he follows in the steps of his Pauline predecessor, makes it improbable that he had command of any rich independent Petrine tradition. His purpose was not historical, in our sense of the word, but was to give Peter a concrete life and activity, and to write his acts so as to make him comparable to Paul. Josephus. That the author of the Acts of the Apostles made use of Josephus among his sources is shown by many details of the narrative. Perhaps the parallelism of the phenomena said to have accompanied the outpouring of the Holy Ghost on the day of Pentecost, chapter 2, verses 1 through 4, with the portents described by Josephus as prophetic of the destruction of Jerusalem, the Wars of the Jews, Book 6, Chapter 5, Paragraph 3, may be taken as evidence. There are, however, clearer traces than this, and other such small coincidences. The mention of Theudas and of Judas the Galilean in Gamaliel's speech, Chapter 5, Verses 36 through 37, is due, evidently, to an imperfect recollection of what the author had read in Josephus. Antiquities, Book 20, Chapter 5, Paragraphs 1 and 2, where the Theudas mentioned, and with him the sons of Judas the Galilean, belong to a later time than that to which Luke assigns the events he makes Gamaliel describe. The Egyptian for whom Paul was taken at Jerusalem, chapter 21, verse 38, is the unnamed prophet out of Egypt, whose expedition, with its defeat by Felix, is recorded by Josephus. Antiquities, Book 20, Chapter 8, Paragraph 6, Wars of the Jews, Book 2, Chapter 13, Paragraph 5. The word Sicari, applied to his adherents, is found nowhere else in the New Testament. It occurs often in Josephus, though not in the two passages referred to, and apparently in no other Greek author. Luke's tendency here is manifest. He seizes the opportunity of illustrating his implied thesis that any harsh treatment of a Christian by Romans must be due to some misunderstanding. In making his Paul predict that God shall smite the high priest Ananias, chapter 23, verse 3, he probably had in memory that the same high priest, whose slaves used to smite those who would not submit to his exactions, Antiquities, Book 20, Chapter 9, Paragraph 2, as he commanded that Paul should be smitten, chapter 23, verse 2, had died a violent death, Wars of the Jews, Book 2, Chapter 17, Paragraph 3. The chief personages connected with Paul's imprisonment and trial, Felix and Drusilla, Festus, Agrippa, and Bernice, are all taken from Josephus. Luke puts together a well-constructed narrative on the basis of their characters as depicted by the Jewish historian, but has no independent, authentic tradition to work on. The narrative itself is an insertion by him in the Acts of Paul. The coincidence with Josephus in the introduction of Festus is even verbal. Compare chapter 24, verse 27, with Antiquities, book 20, chapter 8, paragraph 9. The whole serves the purpose of showing how Christianity, while it was persecuted by the fanatical Jews, was protected by the Roman authorities. 4. General view of the use of sources. From an examination of the whole work, we see how the author now freely recasts the materials in his own manner, now holds himself bound by the words of his documents. A favorite mode of transition with him is the apparently exact, but really indeterminate, "and in those days," chapter 6, verse 1, chapter 11, verse 27, compare Luke chapter 1, verse 39, etc., or "at that time," chapter 12, verse 1. At intervals, he introduces his beloved refrain about the increase of the communities and the growth of the word, chapter 5, verse 14, chapter 12, verse 24. Such an abrupt intrusion as that of Saul identified with Paul into the account of the death of Stephen strikes the eye at once. The establishment of a heathen Christian community at Antioch by Paul and Barnabas, taken over from the Acts of Paul, is modified by the introduction of unknown men of Cyprus and Cyrene, chapter 11, verse 19 through 26, of whom we hear no more. As the last verse shows, the founding of the community was originally ascribed to Paul and his associate Barnabas. This illustrates the method of accommodation by which the Paul of the Paulinists had precursors given him in the preaching of the gospel to the heathen. Paul's gathering of alms for the brethren at Jerusalem, which would seem to have been assigned in the Acts of Paul to a later date, is brought by Luke into connection with what he had read in Josephus about a famine in the reign of Claudius. Chapter 11, verse 28. Compare Antiquities, book 20, chapter 2, paragraph 6, and chapter 5, paragraph 2. He describes the death of Herod with circumstances remembered from Josephus. Antiquities, book 19, chapter 8, paragraph 2. That he gives the name of Silas to the member of the Pauline circle called in the epistles Silvanus is explained by the fact that Silas is the only form of that proper name met with in Josephus. Silas and Barnabas are brought arbitrarily into connection with the community at Jerusalem. In the Pauline tradition, preserved in other passages, they were connected with Antioch. The circumcision of Timothy by Paul, chapter 16, verses 1 through 3, counterbalances the non-circumcision of Titus, Galatians chapter 2, verses 3 through 4, who, perhaps as too much identified with the extreme Pauline school, is not mentioned in Acts. When the chief of the synagogue at Corinth is called Crispus, chapter 18, verse 8, instead of Sosthenes, chapter 18, verse 17, this is probably due to a reminiscence of 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 14. 5. The author's aim. Various intentions have been ascribed to Luke's work, each of them in a manner correctly, so long as none is held to furnish by itself a complete explanation. He did not need to begin the reconciliation of the Petronists and the Paulinists, since others, notably the author of the Acts of Peter, had preceded him in this. But he consciously manipulates his data in the same direction. The approximation, as has already been pointed out, is from both sides. Peter, from the beginning, recognizes that the gospel, though first offered to the Jews, is for all who shall be called. Chapter 2, verse 39. Paul is obedient both to the law and to the other apostles, and makes it his custom to preach first to the Jews, only afterwards turning to the Gentiles. Yet it would be an error to describe such reconciliation as Luke's predominant aim. Even the apologetic aim with regard to the Roman authorities, though this belongs peculiarly to his redaction and not to any of his sources, must be described as the purpose of the whole. What he does by his way of presenting the relations of Jews and Christians and Romans is tacitly to invite the Romans to continue the protective attitude towards Christianity, which, according to the story, they had taken up at first. He combines this, however, with other purposes, such as that of drawing clearly the line between Judaism and Christianity, smoothing over the existing differences among Christians, and so forth. And in the end, it would be unjust not to recognize that his essential purpose is correctly described by himself at the opening of the third gospel, of which the book of Acts, according to his own statement, is a continuation. What he primarily had in view was to give more exact instruction to Christian converts as to the events on which their faith was founded. His purpose was to write history in a sense, sacred history, if you like. 6. His personality. He was evidently not a Jew, but rather a Greek or a Greek-speaking Roman. The Jews always present themselves as men with whom he has nothing in common. His general tolerance and his sympathetic attitude towards Christians on all sides do not extend to them. Penetrated with the Catholic thought of the unity between Peter and Paul, he puts texts side by side to which the opposite parties can appeal, yes and no, on the same page. These, by their juxtaposition, are to serve as a sign that the old differences have become antiquated. For the leaders especially, they never existed. Among Christians, all was, that is, it ought to have been, harmony from the first. Where was the book written? For Alexandria, as also for any place in Greece, there is little to be said. One living in a Hellenic environment would hardly have spoken, as Luke does, of the way in which the Athenians spent their time. Chapter 17, verse 21. And would have known that at Athens there were altars to unknown gods, but not to the unknown God. The quantity of traditional material from Asia Minor gives ground for inference regarding the Acts of Paul rather than the final redaction. For the place of origin of this, most circumstances point to Rome. The writer inserts information about the place or people in referring to Jerusalem, chapter 1, verse 12, chapter 23, verse 8, Macedonia, chapter 16, verse 12, Athens, chapter 17, verse 21, and Crete, chapter 27, verses 8, 12, and 16, but not in referring to places in Italy. There it is as if he was on familiar ground. Compare chapter 28, verses 12, 13, and 15. Latinisms occur, as for example, at the very beginning, chapter 1, verse 1. Above all, Rome was the special seat of the rising Catholicism, and it is not to the pagan state and its citizens generally that Luke directs his apologetics, but definitely to the Romans. There are many indications that the book was composed a considerable time after the age of the apostles. That it was written after the year 70 is certain, the destruction of Jerusalem being presupposed in the author's first book, Luke chapter 21, verses 20 through 24. And there are marks of a much later origin, The writer knows of discord that has arisen in the community at Ephesus after the departure of Paul. Chapter 20, verse 29. The Christian community, or church, has long been established. It has its official elders, or presbyters. Christianity, while fully conscious of its internal continuity with the ancient Israel, has broken with the Jews, and sees itself obliged to appeal to the men in authority among the heathen. The time has arrived when it has to make good its right to exist as an independent religion. Altogether, the canonical Acts of the Apostles cannot be assigned to an earlier date than about 125. The time of its composition may be reasonably placed between 125 and 150. End of Part 1, Section 1. Part 1, Section 2 of The Origins of Christianity by Thomas Whittaker. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Von Manen on the Pauline Literature. Part 1, The Acts of the Apostles. Section 2, Paul According to the Acts. Chapter 1, Paul According to Acts. In the canonical Acts, we find three Pauls. Paul as represented by Luke, the Paul of the Acts of Paul, and the Paul of the Itinerary. The representation of Luke. The inconsequences of Luke's account have already, in part, appeared from the analysis. His Paul is a Jew, and at the same time a Roman citizen by birth. He is of Tarsus, but was brought up from his youth at Jerusalem. He is a tent maker, yet has the leisure to come forward and take a leading part in persecuting Christianity. That he was a teacher in Israel, and had learned a handicraft only in that capacity, Luke does not tell us. We are not told why he is called Saul as well as Paul, why Barnabas alone, after his conversion, was not afraid of him. Chapter 9, verses 26 through 27. Why he, in particular, should have incurred the hostility of the Hellenists. Chapter 9, verse 29. So the account proceeds, without clearness as to the precise causal connection, till his last visit to Jerusalem. Here he is well received by the brethren, yet seems to be personally unknown to almost everyone, in spite of his repeated visits and of his having been educated there. Though he behaves as a pious Jew, his appearance in the temple excites a furious riot. We hear nothing more of any interest taken in him by those who had received him. While he is represented as quite at one with the members of the Christian community at Jerusalem, and while they apparently enjoy complete toleration, the charge of the Jews that he is the enemy of his people and of its law is so constantly presupposed that at Rome, chapter 28, verse 17, he enters upon an apology in advance to those who have never heard of the accusation. Thus, beneath its well-ordered literary clothing, Luke's Life of Paul reveals its unhistorical character in detail. It is full of signs and wonders, and the accounts of some of these are inconsistent, as, for example, that of Paul's conversion. In chapter 9, verse 7, the bystanders hear a voice, but see no man. In chapter 22, verse 9, they see the light, but hear not the voice. The story of the apostle's arrest at Jerusalem and of his imprisonment at Caesarea loses all its air of truth on analysis. To take one detail, Felix, who is said to have hoped for a bribe from Paul to set him free, might have known that he had no means. But in reality, Felix, Drusilla, Festus, Agrippa, and Bernice owe their presence in Luke's narrative entirely to his acquaintance with the works of Josephus, on the strength of which he could judge himself safe in attributing to Felix accessibility to bribes. His weakness in chronology would betray this, if it were not otherwise evident. Festus, as may be inferred from combining the statements of Josephus, Antiquities, Book 20, Chapter 8, Paragraph 9, and of Tacitus, Annals, Book 14, Chapter 65, Book 13, Chapter 14, entered on his procuratorship in succession to Felix not later than 56. For Felix was saved from punishment by his brother Pallas, the court favorite, when the Jews brought complaints against him on his return. And Pallas, who died in 62, had already been removed from court by Nero in 56. Time then being allowed for Paul's journey to Rome, and for his 2 years preaching there, his martyrdom, presupposed by Luke, would have to be placed in 59. This, however, is inconsistent with the tradition he follows, which places it near the time of the fire at Rome in 64. Thus, Luke's data, contradictory as they show themselves, oblige us to seek some other ground than that of authentic record for their actual combination in his narrative. As has been made plain, he did not aim at writing history in our sense. The accounts of Paul that were in his hands had to be modified for edification. The chief document on which he worked, manipulating it in his Catholic sense, was the Acts of Paul. To this we must turn for further light, so far as the distinctive character of Paul set forth in it can still be determined. The Acts of Paul. Here the apostle presents himself as a younger contemporary of the first disciples, not as a member of their circle. In a little time, these are only represented by an occasional survivor, like Manasson, chapter 21, verse 16. Christianity has spread abroad. Apollos of Alexandria has already preached at Ephesus the things concerning Jesus, chapter 28, verse 25. Paul is a citizen of Tarsus, and in the beginning attached to Judaism either by birth or as a proselyte. The writer does not say which. He is a tent maker by occupation, chapter 18, verse 3. At first hostile to the new sect, he is afterwards converted by a vision of Jesus and is sent to the heathen directly by the Lord. He is immediately filled with the Holy Ghost, chapter 9, verse 17, and remains always under its guidance. He makes all plans in accordance with the inspirations and visions granted him. He has the power of imparting the Spirit to others by laying on of hands. His possession is the mark of his converts. He works not among the Jews, but among the nations. To their joy, he is their apostle, chapter 13, verses 47 and 48. The older disciples of Jesus can receive more accurate instruction from him and his disciples, as, for example, Apollos from Aquila and Priscilla, chapter 18, verse 26. It is he and those of his direction who are first called Christians at Antioch, chapter 11, verse 26. With the disciples of the older direction, he sometimes comes into hostile contact. Elymas, the son of Jesus, tries to turn away the hearers of Paul from the faith, chapter 13, verse 8. The movement against him at Jerusalem begins with the believers zealous of the law, chapter 21, verse 20. Originally it was, perhaps, carried forward by them and not by the Jews, on whose broad shoulders Luke seeks to discharge the responsibility. It may have been from them also that the brethren, whom Paul had succeeded in winning to his doctrine, rescued him and placed him in safety at Caesarea. But it is no longer possible to make out how often disciples of the old type, sons of Jesus, are hidden behind the mask of Luke's Jews, hostile to Paul and his preaching. The new doctrine which Paul preaches is the fruit of a revelation granted to him in visions. It is distinguished from that of the old disciples by seeing in Jesus not so much the Messiah promised to Israel as the Son of God. Chapter 9, verse 20. He is still called the Christ, or simply Christ, now become a proper name, but is thought of under that name as a supernatural being. Christ, or the Son of God, is one with the Jesus manifested for a short time on earth and now living in heaven. Precisely how Paul conceived of this unity of Christ and Jesus as coming to be, we are not told. The problem of Christology was left for the future. Jesus himself, in the meantime, recedes into the background. The essential thing is to believe in Christ and to persevere in the faith. Chapter 14, verse 22. In him there is given a new revelation of God, the hitherto unknown. Jews and heathens, also the mere sons of Jesus, stand outside and dwell in darkness, are in the power of Satan. Chapter 26, verse 18. Sons of the devil. Chapter 13, verse 10. But can now come to a knowledge of light, of the highest God, and of his true being. For the new revelation is for all men everywhere. Chapter 17, verse 30. The law is done away with. There is forgiveness of sins through faith in Christ. Faith comes by grace. Grace is communicated by the instrumentality of the chosen vessel. Chapter 9, verse 15. On whose preaching as many as are ordained to eternal life believe. Chapter 13, verse 48. This presentation of Paul, too, in spite of its greater verisimilitude, is one that cannot be held for historical as a whole. The apostle is not quite a man of flesh and blood, but as much of the hero of romance, the idealized personality. Many of the stories about him bear an obviously legendary character, of the same kind, though not so strongly colored, as that of the later apocryphal lives of saints. Then, the content of his doctrine offers a difficulty. Can the development of speculation on the unity of Jesus with a supernatural being, a Christ, the Son of God, have gone so far at a time no later than that even here assigned to Paul? There is a paradox that a Jew or a Greek proselyte to Judaism who has not been a follower of the new way, but a persecutor of its adherents, should no sooner see his error than he comes forth as a reformer of their ideas, preaching a system which, whatever else may be thought of it, bears witness to a deep religious life and long and serious reflection. The Paul of this narrative is among the first preachers of Christianity outside of Palestine. Yet in every country where he arrives, in Syria, in Asia Minor, in Greece, in Italy, he meets with disciples and even brethren. For this stage to be reached, and for the new doctrine to supervene, more time seems necessary than is allowed when he is supposed to be a contemporary of the earliest disciples, even if a younger contemporary. An actual Paul may have given the starting point for the development, and some facts relating to him may have been preserved, but he was not himself the creator of the Pauline gospel of grace, the spiritual father of the Christians of Antioch. such a union of incompatibles as the hero of the Acts of Paul can never have lived and worked. In this shape he may be conceived as the glorified figurehead of a party which attaches its ideas to him in order to commend them in his name. A figure drawn from life he is not. Are we in a position to discover any actuality at all behind this semblance? The Itinerary. To this question, the diary of a fellow traveler of the Apostle gives some answer, but unfortunately not a very circumstantial one, for it only relates the events of a single journey. The real Paul, we may infer, was a traveling preacher. He was a younger contemporary of the other apostles, and his views did not differ materially from theirs. To judge, from the use of the Jewish calendar in the diary, chapter 20, verse 6, chapter 27, verse 9, a use which the hero of the Acts of Paul would probably not have made, his circle had not yet broken with Judaism. We may conjecture that he was originally a tent maker of Tarsus, a Jew or a proselyte to Judaism, that, having at first persecuted the disciples or sons of Jesus, he was gained for their cause, and devoted himself heart and soul to propagating it, that he was one of the first to make their views known outside of Palestine among Jews and heathens, and that this intercourse with the people of various lands detached him from the law. We may perhaps go a step further and try to fill in the outline from the missionary journeys and experiences attributed to him in the Acts of Paul. Perhaps we are justified in concluding that he seldom or never came in contact with the disciples in Palestine, that he remained practically unknown to the brethren at Jerusalem, that on his arrival there at last he nearly fell a victim to his real or imagined want of respect for the temple. All this, however, is uncertain. We must guard against taking for granted the truth of whatever in the Acts of Paul is not manifestly fictitious. At the same time, the diary itself, or rather the fragmentary portion of it which can still be detected beneath the double redaction, presents nothing whatever that is untrustworthy. For regarding the Paul of the itinerary as a fictitious personage, there is no single reason. That a real person should in the course of years be transformed into a hero of romance is a perfectly familiar historical phenomenon. Conclusion. Thus, viewing the Acts of the Apostles for the present without reference to the epistles, we find that only the oldest of the three representations of Paul, which they contain, bring us near the historical reality. Here he presents himself as one disciple along with others. There is no question as yet of Christians or of a break with Judaism. The days of the Holy Spirit have not yet dawned. No one knows that Spirit or fancies himself led by it. Whatever else they may be, the disciples, both in their own estimation and in the judgment of others, are Jews and remain so, either by birth or by having become proselytes. They simply form a direction, a sect among the Jews, not apart from them. The center of their distinctive convictions is Jesus, whose sons or disciples they esteem themselves to be, and in whom they recognize the Messiah promised to their forefathers. To remind one another of the things concerning Jesus, and to declare them to the rest of the world, that is what distinguishes them from the other Jews, and is with them the motive to a pure life and mutual love. To this band of brothers, Paul joins himself. In the service of their ideas, he travels through various lands with varying success. We do not find either that he wrote letters of any importance, or that any divergence about belief or conduct arose between him and the other disciples. The late writer, whom we call Luke, knows indeed of discords that have arisen, but it is significant that in the prediction of them which he puts into the mouth of the apostle, chapter 20, verses 29 through 30, he makes them arise after his departure. A generation, perhaps more, having passed by, a tendency manifests itself outside of Palestine, particularly at Antioch in Syria, to break loose from Judaism. This would be the natural consequence of the accession of heathen proselytes and of intercourse with the Greco-Roman world at large. Accordingly, a new direction appears. The gospel of the Son of God, of grace, of faith is born. The knowledge that Jesus is no other than the Son of God, the Christ, is ascribed to a special revelation, to a communication of the Holy Spirit. The disciples, from a sect of Jews, have become Christians. Those who follow this direction connect it with the name of Paul. Having made him their hero, they proceed to write his life. Yet they can take over almost nothing from that life as it really was, because a grander image of the apostle is before their eyes. Besides, Paulinism, though it has to be attributed to Paul, is really new, and did not belong to the man himself. Hence, the indistinctness in the image of this Paul, according to the Paulinists. We have, in this indistinctness, one evidence that Paulinism was born after Paul's time. That it immediately won approval, we can see, but also that it provoked strong opposition among the old disciples. It is remarkable enough that there is absolutely no hint of any letters written by this Pauline Paul. Years pass by. The strife between the old and the new, in the judgment of influential men, has lost its interest. Peter, the hero of the disciples, as Paul was of the Christians, has been made the subject of Acts on the model of the Acts of Paul. Finally, Luke girds himself up to the task of complete reconciliation, brings the two lives together, and modifies the traditional features of each apostle into approximation to those of his colleague. He is probably acquainted with Pauline epistles, but he does not name them, and he makes sparing use of them. His Paul bears a character other than that of the epistles and of those acts which he diligently used as the basis of his own narrative. Through this process of adaptation, Paul, next to Peter, can become the founder of the Catholic Church. Thus, for those who acquiesce in the composite image presented in the Acts of the Apostles, adolescent Christianity has lost the true sense of its development. What it is, or ought to be now, that it has always been. In essentials, unalterable, one and the same faith for all right-thinking confessors, and especially for the men of name, after whom parties have wrongly called themselves. The sense of development having been recovered, two views founded on the two ideal representations of Paul must be dismissed as untenable. The old Catholic view corresponds to the imaginary portrait painted by Luke. The view of the Tübingen school to the only less imaginary one of the Acts of Paul. No assured reality is left but the Paul of the itinerary. There was, in historical fact, no quarrel between Peter and Paul, but only between the Petrine and Pauline partisans who arose after them. On the other hand, neither apostle taught the principles of Gentile Christianity. Both alike taught simply those of the disciples or sons of Jesus. the apple of discord thrown into the world by Paulinism, was the result of an advance made after the death of the apostle. Or is there some flaw in the argument? Do the epistles forbid us to reject the portrait in the Acts of Paul, along with that of Luke, as unhistorical? The answer to this question must be sought in an investigation of the Pauline epistles. End of Part 1, Section 2.